Good evening. We are on the air. Welcome to the December 20th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. The first order of business on tonight's agenda is approval of the minutes of our last meeting from November 15 of 2005. Have all the board members have had an opportunity to review those minutes? And are there any comments? If not, is there a motion? Okay, David. Any other comments? Do you have a motion? Peter.
I move for approval.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor? Motion carries. We have correspondence before us tonight. A letter from P. Nedwell regarding Spurwink Woods. A letter from the Public Works Director regarding Spurwink Woods. The traffic peer review contract regarding Spurwink Woods. The traffic study regarding Spurwink Woods. The woodlot alternatives wetland study regarding Spurwink Woods. In addition, we received today a note dated December 20, 2005 from Ronald Vincent regarding Spurwink Woods. Memoranda from the Conservation Commission, again regarding Spurwink Woods. A letter from Janet Robinson regarding Spurwink Woods. An email from Stephen Harding of Ost Associates regarding the Raftus private accessway permit. And a letter that was forwarded to us by email from Richard Bryant and Jean Najemi regarding Spurwink Woods. Many of you have probably sent emails to the town planner regarding the Spurwink Woods project. We do have about a one-inch stack of those emails that have been printed out by the town planner. We're all getting them as members of the planning board. If anybody wants to make sure that their email got to us and is part of the public record, you are welcome to visit the town planner's office, but she is printing them out as she gets them, and we are also receiving copies via email. The first item on the agenda tonight is the Brothers Way Murray Private Road Amendment. Steve Murray is requesting an amendment to the private road approval for Brothers Way located off Fowler Road, U20-6, 11-1, to convey a portion of one lot to an abutter with no change to the Brothers Way right-of-way, section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision. This is coming before the board as a consent agenda item, so if there's any substantive discussion that is needed, we will take it off the consent agenda. But if not, then we could simply move forward. I'm not seeing much interest in having any discussion. Is there a motion? Paul?
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the application of Stephen Murray for an amendment to the private road approval of Brothers Way located off Fowler Road to convey a portion of one lot to an abutter with no change to the road right-of-way be approved as a consent agenda item.
Okay. Motion has been made and seconded by Jack. Any discussion? All those in favor? The motion carries. Under old business, the In by the Sea site plan amendments. The In by the Sea has proposed amendments to the previously approved site plan to reconfigure the entrance to adjust the building addition, to construct a mechanical building, and to establish a temporary construction entrance for the inn located at 40 Bowery Beach Road, U17-39/40. The In by the Sea has requested that their application be tabled until spring. Anybody see any issues with that request? Barbara?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the request submitted by the applicant, the application of HMH Limited Partnership for site plan amendments to reconfigure the entrance, adjust the building addition, construct a mechanical building, change the landscaping, and establish a temporary construction entrance for the Inn by the Sea located at 40 Bowery Beach Road be tabled to the June 20th, 2006 meeting of the Planning Board.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries. Next, under old business, the Spurwink Woods Preliminary Subdivision Review and Resource Protection Permit. Spurwink Woods LLC is requesting preliminary subdivision review and a resource protection permit for Spurwink Woods, a 43-unit subdivision proposed for the area between Dermot Drive and Killdeer Road. The application includes 19 condominiums and 23 single-family home lots and 24.97 acres. The comments from the town engineer have been submitted. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 16-2-4 Subdivision Regulations and Section 19-8-3 Resource Protection Regulations. At this point, we will be having a public hearing shortly, but at this point, I would ask the applicant to come forward and bring us up to date with the project.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of the Planning Board, my name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates. And I represent Spurwink Woods, LLC. With me this evening is the applicants. There are three of them, Jim McFarlane, Craig Cooper, and Skip Murray, as well as several members of the project team, which I'd like to introduce. Dale Brewer of Statewide Surveys, who performed the wetland delineation. Tom Gorrell of Gorrell Palmer, the traffic engineer. And Al Palmer of Gorrell Palmer, who provided the civil engineering for this project. Other members of the team who are not here this evening are Owen Haskell, who provided the property line and boundary survey, and planning decisions, who prepared the community fiscal impact study. I think by now, most everyone is familiar with the existing conditions, so unless the board would prefer me to go through the existing conditions again, I'll skip that and get right into the subdivision.
And John, before you go any further, there is a rack of folding chairs in the back corner. If anybody who's gotten here late wants a chair, please feel free to take one and set up either along the side there or in the back. Or you may come to the head of the class if you'd like. Okay, John, thanks. Go ahead.
Okay. As the board remembers, in our packet, we presented the maximum allowable density calculation using the ordinance. And we are permitted 46 lots in. The subdivision is proposing 42 lots. Spurwink Woods consists of a 23 single-family clustered lot and 19 condominium unit subdivision on 25 acres. We utilize the open space zoning provisions of the ordinance, and the average lot size is 9,000 square feet. Lots 11, 21, and 22 11, 21, and 22 have been identified as the lots that will contain the affordable housing units. Lots 21, 22, and 23, all of which have frontage on South Street, will be accessed with a common driveway that will access off of Franklin Circle and access each of those three lots, and this was done to reduce the number of curb cuts off of South Street. The homes are anticipated to be modest in size, ranging from 2,200 to 2,500 square feet. The homes will have three bedrooms and 2.5 baths. And this board here, the top four photos illustrate the architecture and the character for the single-family homes. The 19 condominium units are situated in the westerly portion of the property, and these are divided among 10 buildings. There are 9 two-unit buildings and 1 single-unit building located here. The architecture of the condominiums consists of one-and-a-half-story Cape-style structures, which include a two-car garage per unit. And as this is an illustration of the condominium units. The condos will be designed and marketed toward the empty nesters, which will contain approximately 2,500 square feet. Again, three bedrooms and two-and-a-half baths per unit. The roadway system, consisting of South Street, Franklin Circle, and Chicory Way, has been designed and constructed, and will be constructed to town standards, and is proposed to be a public road. South Street, which is the main street, will connect onto Dermot Drive. It will be 22 feet wide, in accordance with the local road standards. This is approximately 1,350 feet long to this point here. Franklin Circle is a short cul-de-sac off of South Street, is approximately 150 feet long. And Chicory Way, which connects South Street to Kildare Road, is approximately 200 feet long. The public portion of South Street will end at the intersection of Dogwood Lane and Astor Lane. And at this point, the road system will become a private road owned and maintained by the Condominium Association. And there will be an easement at the end of South Street that will be designed in accordance with the town standards for town emergency vehicles. We have designed the project with a sidewalk on one side of the street throughout the development. And this runs along the easterly side of South Street until it gets to Franklin Circle, at which point it crosses South Street. It runs around both sides of Franklin Circle and then continues on the northerly side of South Street down to this point here. We have a crosswalk at this point and a sidewalk running up on the easterly side of Chicory Way. There was a comment in Maureen's memo indicating or questioning why we have a sidewalk on one side and then switch to the other side. The reason for that is the reason for the sidewalk on this side is because of grade and property constraints at the stream crossing. And the reason for the walk on this side is because we are constrained with the width of the property, the right-of-way, and grading in this location here. The layout of Spruimic Woods, the roadway system, the lots, the condominiums, were designed to preserve the more sensitive areas of the property, which would be incorporated into the dedicated open space. The design preserves all of the RP1 wetland, which is situated here. It preserves most of the RP2 wetlands. It preserves the major topographical features and ledge outcrops throughout the property, and much of the vegetation is all incorporated in the open space. Spruimic Woods is incorporating 10.5 acres of open space, which is 42% of the overall parcel, and at least 5.6 acres of this open space is usable. And it is the intention of the applicants to dedicate this open space to the town. We've designed a very elaborate trail system throughout the open space. This has been designed to connect to existing trails and to town-owned property. It is intended to be an amenity for the residents, available for abutting neighborhoods, as well as the general public to use. We are proposing to fill a total of 10,111 square feet of wetland. This is 4.6% of the total amount of wetlands. This includes the associated wetlands that are on either side of the stream, This includes all of the wetlands within the lots, and there are three lots, lots 19, 20, and 23, which the wetlands occur. This also includes a very small pocket of wetland within the paper street, which is located in this area here. And finally, we did meet with the Conservation Commission last week, presented the plan. They were, I think, pleased to with the open space system that we're proposing. They were pleased with the trail system, especially the connectivity that we're proposing. They reviewed the wetland impact, and they voted 5-0 to recommend approval of the resource protection permit with a condition that we install one culvert under Dogwood Lane in this area right here, which we agreed to. And then a final note is that the community impact fiscal impact statement is found in your packet under Exhibit 15. This was prepared by Planning Decisions, and their final conclusion was that this project will yield a net positive fiscal impact of approximately $115,000 to the town. And with that, I'd like to turn this over to Dale Brewer first to talk about. Dale prepared the wetland delineation for this project. I know there's been several comments and questions on some of the emails that have come through concerning the wetlands, and we felt that it would be very important to have Dale speak to you about his methodology and the amount of time that he spent out on the site delineating the wetland. And that will be followed, Dale will be followed by Al Palmer, who will review the updated stormwater management with you, and then Tom Gorrell, who will talk about the traffic. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dale Brewer. I live on Eastman Road in Cape Elizabeth. You may recognize me. I've worked on this current project and several in the past in town here. I'm the owner of Statewide Surveys, Inc., a consulting firm also based in Cape Elizabeth. We provide high-intensity soil survey mapping, all facets of land surveying, and of course, wetland consulting. Our wetland consulting services include wetland delineations. I routinely do wetland function and value assessments. I conduct wetland permitting procedures with the MDEP and the Army Corps of Engineers. We complete wetland mitigation projects where wetland impacts have been experienced or part of the project where mitigation is needed. And we also map wetland boundaries for ourselves and other consultants. I delineated the wetlands found at the proposed Spurwink Woods project this past spring in April, May, June, and July. I've been asked by John to touch on my credentials. I graduated from the University of Maine at Orono with 2 degrees, plant and soil science in 1984, and I got a natural resources degree in 1987. I attained my license as a certified soil scientist in 1992. I've been practicing ever since. I am also a licensed professional land surveyor. And I have also been certified as a wetland delineator by the Army Corps of Engineers under their certification program, which I passed in 1994. I have held several officer positions with organizations and associations in my profession, namely MAWS, the Maine Association of Wetland Scientists, and MAPS, the Maine Association of Professional Soil Scientists, where I was the president for a term. I've been delineating mapping wetlands since 1989, 2 years after the federal and state wetland regulations came into effect in 1987. I worked on projects all over this state, and also New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Connecticut, New York. These projects have ranged from small residential lots to large acreages. I've worked up north with the timber companies on vast acreages and in town on very small residential lots. Many of you on the current board have reviewed previous wetland delineations completed by myself. And looking back, I completed a wetland delineation on Columbus Road back in May 1992. So I have experience in the neighborhood. I have gained extensive experience in the wetland and environmental field through past employment, continuing education, and fellow colleagues. And lastly, I have complete understanding of this Burwank Woods flora and fauna, having recreated on the parcel for years, including all four seasons. I visited the site on 10 occasions for various tasks associated with this project during the time from the contract agreement until my final submittal of my wetland delineation report and plans. The wetland boundary was delineated to the best of my professional ability and very much resembles the wetlands delineated by others on previous development attempts at this parcel. I thank you for your time, and I will do the best to answer any questions or try to address any comments you may have at this time.
Thank you. We may have questions once we've had the public hearing. Thank you.
Okay.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, ladies and gentlemen. Al Palmer from Gorel Palmer. John asked me to give you a brief overview of the proposed changes to the stormwater plan that are currently in progress. To do that, I'm going to kind of just touch base on the design concept that is part of your current package. The current proposal for stormwater was designed in accordance with your ordinances to provide quantity control at various locations as watersheds leave the site. This sketch, and I'm going to try and orient it close to the same direction John has his. Basically, we have three stormwater ponds proposed for the development. The various shades of green are the areas going to the stormwater ponds. There's a stormwater pond proposed here, which is basically taking the flow from the condominium developments before it leaves the site in this direction. There's a detention basin proposed here, collecting the drainage from these lots in Franklin Circle that will then discharge down along this way, and a small detention basin in this location taking the flow from these lots. The stormwater analysis was done in accordance with your ordinance. We've received one set of review comments from your town engineer. They had very minor comments relative to the analysis. The larger macro issue that we dealt with both Steve Harding as well as the town staff, was a desire to eliminate detention basins and retention ponds. We are in the Trout Brook watershed, which flows through South Portland. That's an urban impaired watershed. So it is a watershed that we're concerned with both water quantity and water quality. What we're looking to do in eliminating the ponds and working with the staff is to utilize this large open space area.
Could you remove this while you talk?
Okay, you can't see that one.
Thank you.
Okay. To use this large open space area to help attenuate some of the flows. Working with staff, we've gotten a new interpretation relative to the RP1 wetland and the buffer and setback for that, which does allow us to use this upland area in this location as a vegetated buffer for the stormwater. So what we're going to be proposing to do is to look at eliminating these two basins by using this vegetated upland buffer adjacent to the large wetland complex to help attenuate the flows, get stormwater treatment from those areas also. That will overall reduce the flow going in this direction, and again, what we're hoping is by the reduction of that area, be able to eliminate this retention basin and again use a vegetated buffer in that area with the overall intent to try to eliminate to the extent practicable the use of any ponds and just using open space buffers to provide both stormwater quantity attenuation and stormwater treatment.
I'd be happy to answer any questions the board has.
We can continue on with your the applicant's presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, my name is Tom Gorl. I'm with Gorl Palmer Consulting Engineers, and we were also retained to complete a traffic impact study for the proposed project. I'd like to take a little time tonight to walk you through that study and hopefully give you an understanding of what our conclusions for that study might be. One of the first things we do when we start a study like this is to estimate the traffic that's going to be generated by the project. And we've done that for the proposed development, which we treated as single-family homes, which is the most conservative estimate we can do. That is, it results in the highest estimate. And based on that, we estimate that during the AM peak hour, we'd have about 41 trip ends. 41 trip ends equates, let me explain a trip end. A trip end is either an in or an out. So if you did a round trip someplace, you would have two trip ends. So of those 41 in the morning, a lot of them are leaving. In the afternoon, we would project 51 trip ends in an hour during the peak hour. And again, that translates, actually, in the AM, it translates to about 10 entering and 31 exiting. In the PM, it would translate to 33 entering and 18 leaving. We then superimposed that traffic, those trip ends, if you will, I guess that's okay, on the existing street system, and these figures are contained in the traffic impact study, so this is simply a blow-up of that. And we have, obviously, a network of street systems, and on my, this isn't meant to be to scale, but we have to fit it on one sheet. So more or less, this is Mitchell Road, this is Ocean House Road, Spurwink, then we have Stevenson, and this would be Columbus, and we go down into the site through here. So essentially what we did, the majority of the traffic we did see oriented more toward Portland, if you will, probably being commuter sort of traffic. And so a fair amount of that actually we funneled out toward Spurwink because we did see them going down Spurwink. And in the morning we added, it would be about 10 trips making the right turn and about 5 making a left turn. This is actually, a PM peak hour. And in the coming back here, we have 18 turning left in and 10 turning right in. So that's how those distribute. When we get down to Columbus, the intersection as we come down with Mitchell, we did see some traffic there. In the afternoon, we would see about 2 left turners out, 1 right turn out, and about 2 left turns in, and 3 right turns in. And that's the traffic that is associated with the development itself. So I'll add to that in a little bit. We superimposed this traffic onto the traffic counts that we did do out on the street system, which we need to do also at the beginning of a traffic study. And based on that pre-development traffic, we added this development traffic and came up with estimated post-development traffic volumes. As intersections go, they're not real large volumes. Everything was found from a capacity standpoint to work fine. We did check the MDOT crash inventory data. The DOT keeps a record of any and all collisions that occur that are reportable, which I believe is around $1,000 today. and all those collision reports get sent to DOT. They compile them and by intersection and roadway segment. And we went through all those, and there were no high accident locations. Sight lines is another important thing to look at in terms of access to development, and we spent quite a bit of time looking at sight lines associated with the project. First of all, there's the site drive centrally at Chicory Way, if you will, and Kildare Street, which I guess I can it would be this intersection here on this schematic. And the sight lines there are fine. We do recommend, obviously, a stop sign on the Chicory Way approach. At the intersection with Hamlin Street down in here, we did have adequate sight lines as well. At the intersection with Hamlin and Stevenson, you actually don't have adequate sight lines there today as you look to the right back down Stevenson. They are short. And in order to gain sight lines, you would have to remove a tree that's in this corner here. It's always a balance with aesthetics and how much of an issue it is. One of the things we could consider there, rather than removing the tree, would be to make this a three-way stop, which is probably what we'd recommend. I think it's a good traffic calming device anyway for you, and that eliminates the concern that you would have about sight lines at that location. Another, I think your peer review may have talked about question as to whether or not this movement could sort of become the through movement, as I interpret it, perhaps, and be a stop here. We would, since this is a T intersection, we'd be probably more comfortable with a three-way stop than we would trying to stop just one leg of Stevenson. But that's certainly something that we're open to discussions with you folks as to how you'd like that configured. Stevenson and Spurwink. There's another one we spent quite a bit of time looking at. That intersection, which I think you're all familiar with, we looked at sight lines in a variety of ways. The posted speed limit, if you will, coming around this corner is 30 miles per hour. The actual advisory speed coming around the corner is 20 miles an hour. When you go around that corner, and we've certainly done that, you really... I think you want to go 20 miles an hour. You could potentially go faster than that, certainly, but most of the traffic is going to probably go around 20 miles an hour around the corner. Going 30 miles an hour would be difficult to really do. I suppose if you had the right car, you could do it. But what we had recommended here, first of all, well, options, I would say, to correct, obviously, an existing deficiency that is here, in sight lines, would be to do some clearing of vegetation, both looking in a northerly direction along Spurwink to the right as you were exiting, but also to the left as you're exiting. That would achieve certainly some improvement in sight lines. Question is, again, you know, how much of an impact you want to have in terms of vegetation and that sort of thing, which is a concern. It is an existing kind of situation. We'd like to improve it some if we could. The other option really would be to maybe do some of that clearing, but not remove any really significant vegetation, and potentially look at a three-way stop at that location, obviously with advanced signage and that sort of thing. The other sight line that we look at as well is if you want to turn left onto Stevenson from Spurwink, you do have sight line issues as you're looking down Spurwink to the south. Again, the three-way stop sign would correct that, and I think that was something that the peer review of the project indicated was an option as well. Things like roundabouts could work there, but again, you're kind of constrained with the land that's available for that and the impacts that we potentially would have if you implemented that sort of solution. So I think a kind of a combination of some judicious clearing with an eye toward minimizing impacts, if you will, on abutters, and a three-way stop would be an appropriate way to address that existing issue. The intersection of Kildare and Columbus was fine. We'd recommend installation of a stop sign at the Kildare approach. The other sight line we spent some time with was at the intersection with Mitchell in Columbus. This is somewhat of a schematic of Columbus coming up here and Mitchell going around here. If you're exiting Columbus onto Mitchell, again, this is an existing condition, you don't really have adequate sight lines out there today for what you generally like to have. They can be improved, and they can be improved primarily by clearing. That's really your only option probably as you look to the left. As you look to the right, there is some clearing that would need to occur in this quadrant here, but this right-of-way we've plotted on here, you actually could make the improvement within the existing right-of-way, it appears, to obtain adequate sight lines. So that would address that situation. So that was the sight lines. Another question really was the speed, which is somewhat combined with the cut-through traffic potential issue, and I know there's been a lot of discussion certainly with that. In terms of the speed on Columbus, it is somewhat of a straight roadway. Today, I know there's been concern about speeding along Columbus, and it is obviously today the only people there would be the people that live there. So if they're speeding, it could be potentially addressed just through a neighborhood program. To the extent that the additional traffic is there, we can look at, you know, some traffic calming techniques. We're happy to work, you know, with the neighborhood. There are some things that we think, you know, are fairly effective, and that's one of the things that we think is effective is how we lay out the development. And I think that's very important, especially since there is a concern about cut-through traffic. And I guess just to do, what did I do with it? Did I put it up here already? Or did it, there it is right there. Just to take a look, I know we looked at potentially the traffic, this being the intersection of Mitchell Road coming down through here, and this is the proposed development in through here. This is Kildare, this is Columbus. So we sort of looked at a point, this just happens to be obviously one route, but the question really is, would traffic, I think, come down and want to go through this area or vice versa? And it was our conclusion as we looked at this, and it seems to be the conclusion of the peer review, that the cut-through traffic really would not be significant. I'm not going to tell you there wouldn't be any, because I think, you know, there is the potential for some cut-through traffic. But if we do look at the development here, if I'm, for instance, over here somewhere, obviously I'm going over that direction, people that were at this common point to get over toward Portland would travel down this route, down to Cottage Road. If they were thinking about cutting through the development, it would be something like this. It's about the same distance. So right on the surface, it doesn't look to me like we've got a big cut-through problem there. But I understand absolutely the concern that neighbors have, and it's a concern that we have consistently as we deal on the municipal side with a lot of neighbors. Interconnecting developments so that you can potentially go from one development to the other can be a very good thing. It's encouraged from a planning standpoint. A lot of dead-end roads today have led to a lot of problems, but at the same time, the real key issue is to make sure that you don't have the cut-through traffic, and interconnectivity is a very good thing. So the way this has been laid out is really to minimize cut-through traffic. Obviously, it's connected into the intersection with Kildare Road here on the corner, and we've got a variety of stop signs and other techniques in here in terms of potentially raised crosswalks, and people needing that want to come through here would have a stop. They'd have to come down Chicory Way and have another stop, have some traffic calming through here, and it is the way it's laid out. It's laid out with, you know, some curves in it on purpose. A lot of the times we're brought in to try to calm traffic perhaps in an existing neighborhood, and we don't have the luxury of sort of going back and relaying things out. What we do then a lot of times, yes, we have the raised crosswalks, we have chicanes and that sort of thing, but I think with the layout that you have here, this roadway, it's really conducive to slowing the traffic. We would have a stop sign here. We did see traffic going down Dermot and down Hamlin to another stop sign. We did think that a stop sign at the intersection of Dermot and Hamlin would be a good idea, as it would be at the intersection of Hamlin, again, with Stevenson. So we don't really want to make a wide, straight roadway. We're trying to make a circuitous roadway, essentially, to keep the speeds down, but that's also contributing to keeping the potential, whatever potential there is there, for the cut-through traffic to a minimum. And if, in terms of traffic calming on Columbus, we don't know that that would be a problem. I would certainly welcome the opportunity for a dialogue on that. Some of the things that have been done in the past certainly include things like the roadway narrowing, where you have like a chicane or you have a raised intersection or a kind of a speed bump, that kind of thing. In terms of sidewalks, I know that's been mentioned as well. And in terms of traffic calming, you may pick up some with sidewalks. I would say you're probably going to pick up maybe 3 mile an hour would be my guesstimate, sort of speed reduction. So not a big speed reduction there. So I think I'm in conclusion, I guess, on the cut-through. I'm really not sure it's too big an issue. I would agree with the peer review that it's probably not a significant amount of traffic, but at the same time, any traffic is a lot to the neighborhood. So we're certainly open to the traffic calming options that you may want to discuss with us. So with that, that pretty much concluded our traffic impact study. You have a complete study before you, and we'd be happy to answer any questions at the appropriate time.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Tom. I'd like to conclude our presentation with just providing a few comments relative to Maureen's memo. I've just selected just a few in her memo dated December 20th, which I'd like to review with you. The first one is on page 1 under proposed streets. Actually, it continues on page 2. The last paragraph under A, where she talks about the property north of the proposed South Street lots, which is this section of land here, which is owned by Spurwink Woods LLC. However, it's not part of this project. And the reason for that is, if you remember, this is the piece of land that was which was purchased from the town. The town sold it to the applicant. However, it does not have clear title. And the applicants do not want to extend our proposed South Street down along the frontage of that property because that property can't be built on. We don't know when the title will be cleared. It may be a year, it may be several years. But we did want to bring that to your attention. Under paragraph C, landscaping, we are certainly, we noted Maureen's concern there, and we are not opposed to adding a few supplemental evergreen trees in this area where South Street comes the closest to the neighboring properties. So that's something that we will do. Under paragraph I, stormwater, Al Palmer provided an overview of the revised stormwater management plan that he's working on. Under paragraph N, sidewalks, in my presentation, I explained to you why we brought the sidewalk to the opposite side of the road. It was for grading and property line constraints. With relative to the sidewalk on Kildare and Columbus, Tom touched on this, and basically the applicants feel that having to build a sidewalk from the intersection of Chicory Way down Kildare and all the way down Columbus is unfair. It's an unfair request. The length is 2,000 feet long, and by the time you cut out the pavement and put in a new sidewalk and an esplanade and tree plantings for that amount of distance, it is significant. It's a significant cost. However, the applicants feel that perhaps a more equitable way to handle this is to contribute some amount towards either a sidewalk or traffic calming measures. And that was it for Maureen's memo, and then Steve Harding's letter, which is dated December 12th. We basically agree with all of his comments. They are fairly minor in detail, and they will all be addressed in our next submission. So that concludes our presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. At this point, I want to open the public hearing for the Spurwink Woods application. I would ask each person who wishes to speak tonight, and we would like to hear from everybody who wishes to speak tonight, I would ask that you come to the podium, tell us who you are and where you live, and if you are near the development, if you want to just point out to us where you are, that may help us understand your comments better. The only other request I would make is when we have somebody speaking, if we could get at least three people to kind of line up behind the speaker over there on the side so that when the speaker finishes, the next person can jump right in and begin their comments. Otherwise, what we found in these public hearings before is there's a good half a minute or minute gap while we're waiting for the next person to make their way from the back of the room up to the podium. And you may think that builds the suspense, but what it really does is add to the length of the hearing. So without further ado, I will open up the public hearing and invite your comments on the application.
Mr. Chairman and members of the panel, my name is Paul Katsos. I live at 33 Columbus Road. That's on the end, a little bit closer to Mitchell Road. I've written to the panel before with some of my comments with regard to traffic. I would join in the comments which were written to the board in Richard Bryant's thoughtful letter of December 19, which the chair indicated has just been received. What I wanted to talk to the panel about, in addition to the written comments, was just the observations I made during the site walk. And that took an amazingly short time to walk from the proposed entrance in the Dermot to Kildare space that's proposed with Spurwink Woods, notwithstanding the snow. It's clear to me, as someone who's lived in that neighborhood, that it will be a shortcut. Based on the measurements, it's at least a mile less for people to get from our part of the neighborhood to head west. And while I respect the opinions put forth by the traffic engineer that it may not be quicker to go to Portland, as you head west towards the mall and towards other areas, it will be quicker. And those of us who live in the neighborhood and know how long it takes to go all the way around Mitchell to get around the marsh area that runs between it and Sawyer know that this will be a significant shortcut, just as anyone who takes the bicycles through the woods knows how quick it is to get to Eastman when you can actually cut through the woods. We've heard that there will be 42 units, and based on that, there's been estimates of a limited amount of traffic. I don't know if anyone's made an effort to estimate how much cut-through traffic there will be, but as someone who lives in the neighborhood, I urge you to consider that we believe there will be a significant change with regard to the tenor of Columbus Road and the neighborhood which we've lived in, which is a quiet, dead-end loop. That change will invariably affect the property values in the neighborhood for the 50 people who live on the Columbus side, and we'd ask the Planning Board to consider limiting the scale of the project, the size of the project, and give particular attention to focus on the traffic patterns, because we don't believe that the changes proposed for Spurwink Woods will significantly slow down the cut-through traffic. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Richard Bryant. My wife and I wrote a letter to you that I know has been accepted into the record. I won't reiterate everything in that letter, but I do want to hit some of the highlights of it here. I live at 55 Spurwink Avenue, which, for those of you who are out on the sidewalk, is the house that's on the inside of the curve on Spurwink, immediately opposite Stevenson. If I can find one of the items used here. This is Stevenson coming down. This is Spurwink. My house is right here. And in fact, you will notice that my house right here is approximately 13 feet from the edge of the pavement. My wife and I are opposed to this development. We think it is simply too large and too intense a development for this property. More importantly, we think that Spurwink Woods does not meet the standards of the subdivision regulation, because it adversely affects the health, safety, convenience, and general welfare in Cape Elizabeth. And it does not fit harmoniously into the existing natural environment and rural character, and those are defined to be the purposes of the subdivision regulation. More specifically, there are standards which the Planning Board is required to observe in approving a subdivision, and there are at least four of those standards which Spurwink Woods does not fit. I noted them, the citations in my letter, but basically Spurwink Woods will cause unsafe conditions with respect to the use of roads. It will have an undue adverse effect on scenic and natural, in the natural beauty of the area. It does not conform with the comprehensive plan. And finally, it's going to adversely affect the quality of some of the wetlands. My foremost concern is really traffic issues. And I have read the initial traffic report. I've not read the peer review that was apparently submitted. I didn't get a copy of that. I'm not sure when it was submitted. But I think the traffic study misses a few really major points. Right now, Killdeer and Thrasher on the Columbus neighborhood are very narrow streets, and the way they're configured, they don't serve any other streets. Nobody travels on those streets to get to Columbus. They serve only the limited number of houses that are located upon them. When this project is built, if it's built in the current configuration, they're going to have to handle all the traffic from all 42 homes built in Spurwink Woods. They're going to have to handle all of the traffic in the 12 existing units within the Stevenson neighborhood that want to travel easterly or southerly. And they're going to have to handle all the traffic from the other 50 plus units in the Columbus neighborhood that want to travel westerly. So what will happen is that it's not simply the traffic that's generated by Spurwink Woods superimposed upon the existing traffic. Spurwink Woods, by the nature of its cut-through, is going to affect the traffic pattern so that Stevenson Avenue neighborhood is going to use Springweek Woods and Columbus, necessarily going over Killdeer and probably Thrasher. And the Columbus area homes will necessarily use Killdeer and Thrasher to get through Springweek Woods on the way to Stevenson and Springweek whenever you're traveling west. Columbus Road deserves some special consideration because if you've driven there and looked at it, it is a straightaway. And the public comments at the neighborhood meeting also highlighted that fact. At a minimum, we think that, at least I think, that the planning board ought to require the developer who's going to impose all of this traffic on those neighborhoods to put sidewalks throughout those neighborhoods and to use those sidewalks to reconfigure Columbus Road as a chicane, as the traffic engineer suggested, or in some other manner so that you slow down that straightaway effect. Right now, if there is a traffic problem on Columbus because of its a long straightaway, there's at least peer pressure in the neighborhood. And I'm sure that neighbors will tell you if they see somebody dashing down that road at 40 miles an hour while their kids are out playing there, they're going to make a call and they're going to give a look to the driver, and that's neighbors who are looking at neighbors. Once you put Springweek Woods into the mix, the people who are driving through this neighborhood are not the neighbors of the people who live there. So the social constraints on traffic speed all go away, and instead you have to rely on physical constraints. With respect to the Stevenson neighborhood, which consists of Stevenson, Hamlet, Dermot, and part of South Street, those also are homes that will have to suffer the traffic coming from Springweek Woods and from Columbus and Points East. South Street deserves special attention because, as you can see on this map here, South Street continues down, makes a left-hand turn, and then connects into Stevenson. What's proposed here is, as described earlier today, was that this is going to be a driveway extension for these lots. In fact, it's going to be a street. But that street is going to end or connect to an existing private way, which is not up to town standards. The traffic engineers are talking about putting stop signs here and here and maybe down at the end of Hamlin. Probably most of the traffic will come through Dermot Drive, Hamlin Street, out Stevenson, but there will surely be traffic that continues straight down South Street, wings along this substandard private way to get onto Stevenson and avoid these traffic calming measures that are proposed up here. The developer owns this property right now. The developer, if it's going to have the subdivision approved, should be required to include this property within the subdivision and to include South Street as to make that improved to the standard of a public way. In the same way that the planning department has told the developer, you have to include this lot here on Killdeer as part of your subdivision, even though it was part of a prior approved subdivision, you should require the same thing to occur down here. There may be a title issue that they may take their time to solve, as suggested here, but that shouldn't stop you from requiring them to improve the road traffic. I would also note the term connectivity was used tonight because it's a big concept. I'm sure you're all aware of the petition that's out to stop cut-through traffic, exactly like this situation. You have a perfect example here of why connectivity might make sense. Instead of fronting all the traffic through this one single road here, if you force the developer to do the right and logical thing to connect to the other traffic way that also feeds into Stevenson, that's connectivity, and that's going to disperse the traffic through the neighborhood and limit the adverse effects on these abutting properties. I think specifically of Mr. Newman here, whose front porch is going to be in the direct line of all the headlights coming down Dermot Avenue and presumably stopping at a stoplight and shining in his living room before they turn. If you allow, or if you require the developer to include South Street and to improve that, you can make this circle a one-way, unidirectional traffic pattern, disperses the traffic equally amongst all the neighborhood, and also solves the problem with Mr. Newman's property here. Sidewalks as well, because these are also properties in which people walk, roads in which people walk and bicycle. So to the extent, if you're going to put a lot of car traffic through here, as you inevitably will if you approve this project in its current form, You ought to do something with sidewalks to make sure you segregate the pedestrian traffic from the vehicle traffic, perhaps bike lanes as well. The Grill-Palmer traffic study has, I think, missed a few really big points. The biggest one is the cut-through traffic. You were shown an example here of measurement of distance between Mitchell and Columbus heading up towards Broadway and Broadway and 77, which I think is actually right up here. In their traffic study, they suggest that since the distance from this point to this point using this route is 350 feet closer than going this direction, that all the traffic is going to logically say, great, I'll head this way. That's hogwash. Anybody in Columbus Avenue, in the Columbus Avenue neighborhood, who's more than 175 feet from this intersection, which is virtually every single house in this place, is going to go this way because it's actually shorter. They won't go east to get west. Secondly, they're in...
I just want to orient myself. When you say this intersection, is that Columbus Road and Mitchell Road?
This is Mitchell and Columbus right here.
Thank you.
Okay. Secondly, their dismissal of the cut-through traffic issue is focused on this arbitrary trip. What they don't look at is everything west of here. I, on this map, live, let's see, right here. When I head to the mall or any place other than downtown Portland, I never go up to Broadway and over because of the congestion and the traffic light, and it's longer. I always head over on Highland and cut up Stillman and cut up by the South Portland High School. I avoid all of that traffic. Anybody in this neighborhood who's going to any place other than Portland to the west is going to cut through Spurwink and go the same way I do. Similarly, Oakhurst Road is right here. Anybody in this Oakhurst area or over here who's going other than to downtown Portland is going to cut through here. It's going to be quicker. By the same token, I happen to referee a lot of softball games during the summertime, during the spring. Whenever I'm heading to Fort Williams from my property, I'm not going to take this 1.2 mile additional trek up around here to get over to Fort Williams or Playstead Park. I'm going to go right through this development. Everybody who thinks that way, which is everybody who drives and has any familiarity with the area, is going to see this as a cut-through and will take advantage of it. Just like water seeking its own level, traffic will find the cut-through and will use it. Another issue that was completely ignored by the traffic study was the issue of construction traffic. We heard at the public meeting comments that this may take 3, 5, 8 years to build out, and that there's an awful lot of ledge to be blasted, there's an awful lot of infrastructure to put in, plus you've got to build 42 homes, which you're not going to do in one season. There's nothing in the traffic study that addresses the construction traffic issue, which is going to include not only heavy equipment to do all the infrastructure work, but is also going to include the tradesmen's traffic for building each of these houses as they're built out over the next 5 to 10 years. So that's another impact that's completely ignored by the traffic study that's going to directly affect these two neighborhoods, Stevenson and Columbus. I've not read the peer review of the Grill-Palmer traffic study, but I would urge that we should have an independent traffic study that addresses those issues, that doesn't avoid them. There's also at least a question with the data in the Grill-Palmer traffic study. Their data shows that for PM peak hours on the Stevenson neighborhood, there are approximately 13 cars coming in and 14 cars going out, while over on the Columbus side, there are, I forget what it was, 31 cars going out with 15 going in, or vice versa. A ratio of one car in to one car out in one neighborhood and two cars to one car in the other neighborhood suggest that there's either something flawed about the data or something flawed about the analysis. The numbers just don't make sense. And when you look at the overall question of how much traffic is going to be generated here, to think that 42 houses, each with two car garages, are going to generate, in a typical two income family in Cape Elizabeth, is going to generate one car trip rather than two car trips a day is just silly. It just doesn't make sense. There will be more traffic than what they project will be coming through here.
Mr. Bryant?
Yes.
You've been going for...
I'm sorry.
I mean, I've been 15 minutes, so if you could... we have your letter.
I will wind it up in 2 minutes for you.
Okay.
I would note that the comprehensive plan shows rural protection areas going through this neighborhood here. It also delineates it as a growth area, so certainly some growth is allowed, but you can't ignore the rural protection area set forth in the current comprehensive plan. With respect to the wetlands, I think you need another wetland study. I understand Mr. Brewer's qualifications. It just does not make sense to me and anybody who's been in those woods to think that those vernal pools there, which are inundated at least 4 months out of the year, do not have wildlife in them. You can hear the peepers in the springtime, and I'm sure other neighbors will testify about the wildlife, the amphibians they've seen there. It just doesn't make sense. That ought to be confirmed in the breeding season in this spring. And then my last point just has to do with my house at 55 Spring. The trimming of vegetation that was suggested by Grove Palmer would cut down a 200-year-old cedar tree that's been there since that house was built in 1800. It would also cut down the hedges that have been there for at least, I think, 80 years since Spurwink Road, which has been there forever, has started having automobile traffic. That's a buffer that makes my house livable. Their proposal to cut down the vegetation first, and if that doesn't work, put up three-way stop signs, is exactly backward. What they ought to be doing is increasing the buffer. If you do have to do something, you should put a single stop sign for traffic going northerly on Spurwink. If you put a three-way stop there, you're going to have cars stopping on a very steep hill on Spurwink, and the noise from that is going to be 10 times as disruptive to the houses around than what's there now. And with that, I'll hush up and let somebody else talk.
My name is Claudia Drico. I live at 70 Columbus Road, which is about here, if this is Columbus Road. And I just want to mention that this is the largest group of people I've spoken in front of since the first grade. When I narrated the Christmas play for the entire elementary school, I was traumatized and stage struck ever since. So for me to stand up here 40 years later, perhaps to the day, it means I feel very strongly about this. On December 10th, I participated in the sidewalk for the Spurwink Woods development. It was a gorgeous morning and the woods were stunning. Several times during the walk, Mike McGovern was heard to say, "This is beautiful." As the site walk progressed, it became increasingly clear to me that the very pine forest through which we were walking would no longer exist as a result of the Spurwink Woods development. The building of the proposed road, which runs straight through the pine forest, will require blasting and extensive grading due to the ledge outcroppings and hummocky nature of the terrain. Where the road does not abut the McCall residents up here, it has housing lots on both sides. To build the proposed 2,200 to 2,500 square foot homes on the proposed size lots, all being less than a quarter acre, virtually all the trees on those lots will have to be cut down to make way for construction equipment and the underground utilities. Between the construction of the road itself, the 23 building lots, and the 19 condos, there will be relatively few trees remaining in Spurwink Woods, an ironic name for this development. Consequently, the proposed trail, beginning at the town lot on Macaulay, will not be in the middle of the woods, as it appeared to be on that Saturday morning. At most, there will be a small buffer of trees on either side of the trail. The start of the trail would run approximately 30 feet.
Could you remove that?
Sure. It'll be 30 feet from existing properties. Then it will cut between two Spurwink Woods lots with about 40 feet to spare on each side to the lot lines. It then crosses the road and cuts between two more lots with as little as 15 feet to those lot lines. After the trail splits to the south, it crosses the road again and runs about 15 feet from existing properties and 30 feet from the proposed condos. In other words, for the most part, those walking on the trails will not be walking in the woods. They will have a clear view of their neighbors and vice versa. The 10.48 acres of proposed open space consists of a scrubby knoll of bedrock in RP1 and two wetlands, an area obviously undesirable for development due to the need for blasting and wetland constraints. I have a hard time understanding the rationale for cluster housing in this particular case. If it is to provide more open space or preserve the natural environment, then this development falls seriously short. Approximately 15 acres of pine forest habitat will be destroyed in the making of this development. As far as the original traffic study is concerned, and we've all heard about this ad nauseum, but it doesn't take into account cut-through traffic within Cape and South Portland. For example, those people from Mitchell Road and points east, such as Oakhurst, Stonegate, Shore Road, Cranbrook, etc., going to Maxwell's Farm Market, Purputic, or heading to Scarborough Beach. Or those people to the west of 77 who have children at Ledgemere Day School on Mitchell Road, or at Maiden Cove School off of Shore Road, or people going to Fort Williams, or the Irving Station, or the Cookie Jar. Another problem I have with the traffic study is the site distance looking left onto Mitchell Road from Columbus. The study says that with trimming of vegetation, the site distance will increase from 180 feet to 250 feet. As all of us who live in the Columbus Road neighborhood know, the limiting factor in the site distance is the hill right before the intersection of Columbus and Mitchell, making it an intersection requiring extreme caution. This will not change if a few bushes are cut. The hill will still be there. Calming measures such as stop signs will be needed within the Columbus Road neighborhood. I also believe calming measures such as stop signs, speed tables, harsh corners, and a winding road are necessary within Spurwink Woods in order to deter cut-through traffic. The increased traffic to the existing neighborhoods has not been sufficiently addressed. I am strongly opposed to this development because of the negative impact it will have on the natural environment and the existing neighborhoods, and as a result, I believe it should be seriously reduced in scope.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, the board, thank you for this opportunity. My name is Hank Andolsek. I live at 70 Columbus Road. I'm opposed to this project for several reasons. First, there are too many homes on lots that are too small, and once the developers complete the project, the small lots will be essentially devoid of trees, which is a stark contrast to the surrounding neighborhoods. The proposed condos and multifamily units will reduce the resale value of the existing homes in the surrounding neighborhoods. And as shown in recent polling, Cape Elizabeth residents do not favor more condos or more multifamily units. The proposed walking trails are quite frankly a joke. They are too close to the proposed housing, less than 30 feet, as Claudia mentioned, to the proposed condos. The proposed trail passes by the anything but scenic stormwater detention basins and through seasonally impassable wetlands. Trails should be laid out so they are usable year-round and be non-obtrusive to surrounding residents. The creation of a through traffic shortcut will ruin the character of the Columbus Road neighborhood. It will create an unsafe situation in a currently safe neighborhood. A petition has been circulated to stop the development of shortcut through streets in existing neighborhoods. Over 750 signatures have been gathered thus far from residents who believe in preserving the character of these neighborhoods. Please listen to what these residents are saying. The board members had a chance to view the beauty of the property during the recent site walk on December 10th. Unfortunately, most of the majestic hemlock and pine trees that many of you no doubt admired during that walk will be taken down during the project construction. The clearing of these great trees is not only unfortunate for the residents who enjoy the simple beauty of these woods, but also for the large number of deer that take shelter there during the harsh winter storms. What the board didn't see on the walk due to the snow cover was how much alive the wetlands are. The pool that exists in upper wetland A, as shown on the sheet number 2 of the development plan, I don't have that here, but it's not. It's not marked down anyway, but you have the plans, so. Has all the earmarkings of a vernal pool. Vernal pools are vital to the survival of amphibians in forested wetlands, and this particular pool has been observed by neighbors on Killdeer to contain amphibians during spring and early summer months. I urge you to hold off with approving any plans until the status of this pool can be verified later next spring. Recent polling shows that the vast majority of Cape residents place a high value on the preservation of natural landscape and the environment. Please listen to what the residents are saying. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Holly Hoffman. This is my husband, Lyndon Keck. We live at 42 Columbus Road. Our home is opposite the corner where Killdeer Road intersects Columbus. I bought my home in 1999, and I specifically chose to pay more for a home in a quiet, dead-end neighborhood. I wanted the safety of a dead-end road for my young family. The traffic pattern that will result from this development, as currently proposed, has a direct negative impact on both the safety of my family and the value of my property. I am not opposed to growth, I'm not opposed to development, and I'm not opposed to connectivity. But I do believe these principles must be applied thoughtfully and judiciously. And I am adamantly opposed to development patterns that destroy the character of existing neighborhoods. I am adamantly opposed to development patterns that damage other people's investments and jeopardize the safety of families. Spurwink Woods, as currently designed, does all three. In fact, I count 75 homes in three neighborhoods that face significant property value reduction. I urge the Planning Board to reduce by half, at least, the number of units built, to disallow multiple family units, and to not allow these neighborhoods to be connected in this way. I hope that my Planning Board will work hard to protect the safety and value of existing neighborhoods and to encourage quality development that we can all be proud of. Thank you.
My name is Lyndon Keck. I'm the other half of the Hoffman Keck family at 42 Columbus Road. I wanted to touch on some of the technical aspects that Holly and I have been concerned about on this project. First is that Section 16-1-1 of the subdivision ordinance promotes, quote, development that fits harmoniously into the existing natural environment and rural character of the town. Holly and I contend that this project's large-scale, exceptionally small house lots, extensive rock blasting, and extensive land clearing will not allow this project to fit harmoniously into the existing natural environment, and it will certainly not reinforce the town's rural character. Secondly, we do not believe that the usable open space as designated by the developer satisfies the requirements of Article 3, Section 16-3.1, subparagraph M, which states that multiplex housing and cluster development shall be so designed and laid out as to, quote, minimize disturbance of existing topography and ground cover, provide maximum usable, natural, or improved open space, and be compatible with any surrounding land uses and their character. More specifically, we request the board to seriously evaluate the usefulness of the designated open space, which by our calculations comes to 3.61 acres, and which includes detention basins and odd slivers of land on which the developer was unable to develop house lots. We believe that the intent of the ordinance is to create usable land, which is truly usable by the public and which includes major set-asides of forested, usable land not inhabited by detention basins and not including required 20-foot buffer areas adjacent to existing neighborhoods. We request the board take a serious look at the quality of the open space and the true intent of the ordinance. Bedrock. We request the board require a certified geologist review and study, which would include a bedrock contour map of this parcel. We believe this parcel is essentially all rock that is overlaid by very shallow organic and silt soils. Extensive blasting will have an impact on adjacent wells, foundations, and houses. In addition, we believe that bedrock on the site is substantially larger than the 0.2 acre as represented on the plans. The board and the neighborhood should understand that there will be extensive blasting required for construction of all portions of this project. Blasting will be required for roads, utilities, foundations, detention basins, even the planting of trees. This is an exceptionally rugged site that previously would have been passed over by developers as undevelopable because of the expense of rock removal. Chicory Way conflict. We request the board review the intersection of Chicory Way and Killdeer Road. We believe there are two serious planning problems. Lot number 11 is an existing house lot as part of another approved subdivision that is now being made into a substandard lot. This is not a new lot. This is not a new dwelling. It should be preserved under the 20,000 square foot minimum lot requirements for Residence C District. In addition, Chicory Way is directly adjacent to and opens onto the driveway of a residence belonging to Hills. We believe a traffic engineer should review the safety hazards that will be created by vehicles blocking out of that driveway and onto the intersection of three roads. Number 5, stream crossing. The new proposed stream crossing at South Street raises two concerns. The first is that the inlet for the stream crossing is actually on another parcel of land owned by a different developer. This will require stormwater from the Spurwink Woods development to leave their land, cross onto an abutting parcel before entering the culvert. Additionally, the side slopes of the road are exceptionally steep and do not appear to be in conformance with the town ordinance for side slopes for roadways. 6, we request the town engineer hire an independent traffic engineer to review the suitability of adding more traffic to Killdeer Road. We believe Killdeer Road is substandard and does not meet the town's subdivision standards for town roads. We question the wisdom of dumping so much traffic from a new 24-foot wide road onto a narrow substandard road. 7, public trails. We find the proposed trail system around the condominiums to be impractical. The trails actually wander onto condominium private land and come within 17 feet of units 3 and 4. It is impossible to imagine the residents of those units allowing strangers to walk within 17 feet of their bedroom windows. 8, extended trail system. In addition, the trail system wanders through ditches and swale areas behind units 11 and 12. The trail system also travels through RP2 wetland areas. The town should be concerned about erosion in all of these areas where the trail system passes through sensitive wetland areas or through ditches and drainage swales. 9, neighborhood density. This project is much too large and is much too dense. The new house lots are generally smaller than 1/5 acre, yet surrounding neighborhoods have house lots that vary from 1/3 acre to over 1 acre. The subdivision ordinance specifically states that a project should be, quote, compatible with surrounding neighborhoods, and a development should fit harmoniously into the existing natural environment and the rural character, end quote. We do not believe that house lots that are 1/5 acre comply with the definitions of rural character and are not compatible with the adjacent neighborhoods where house lots are 200% to 400% larger. We understand the town planner will be asking for a waiver so the developer does not need to build detention and retention basins. We believe this is in violation of existing federal and state environmental laws, which require stormwater runoff not to be dumped directly into sensitive wetland areas, as was previously explained tonight. It requires developers to release post-development runoff at the same rate of release as pre-development. We do not support the elimination of the detention and retention basins. Excessive grading. We request the Planning Board review the proposed grading plans, which we believe show the project does not fit harmoniously into the existing natural environment. Specifically, units 11, 12, 13, and 14 are built on large artificial raised plateaus, which are as much as 15 feet above the existing grade, and which require the filling of RP2 wetland areas, as the developer explained tonight. Traffic, number 10. Our primary objection to this project as presently designed is that it converts two quiet dead-end neighborhoods into through-traffic shortcut neighborhoods. The Cape Elizabeth Planning Board rules and regulations state that the site plan review is intended to minimize adverse impact, such as traffic, lighting, waste disposal, and stormwater flow on abutting properties and taxpayers. Article 3, Section 16-3-1 specifically states, quote, "The Planning Board may require that local roads be laid out so that their use by through traffic will be discouraged," end quote. Home buyers look for and pay premium prices for homes on dead-end streets. Subsequently, they contribute more taxes to the town's tax base. Loop roads and dead-end streets create defensible space that results in slower traffic, quieter and safer environments where children can play with little fear of fast-moving shortcut traffic. 11, traffic impact study. Just a few more minutes, Mr. Chairman. We've reviewed the traffic study and take issue with both its methodology and its conclusions. First, the study's biggest flaw is that it assumed that drivers on all roads travel at the posted speed limits. No real data was collected to determine at which speed cars and trucks actually travel. This is especially important on Columbus Road, Mitchell Road, and Spurwink Road. The existing traffic study assumes speed limits as low as 25 miles per hour on Stevenson and Columbus Road, simply because these roads are not posted. As residents of Columbus Road, we can assure you that the traffic travels much faster than the posted speed limit on both Columbus and Mitchell. Site distance looking to the left onto Mitchell Road from Columbus Road is not only restricted by vegetation, but is also restricted by vertical drop in elevation. This does not allow cars to be seen as they approach Columbus Road from the left. This cannot be solved by cutting down bushes. We do not agree with the traffic impact study that suggests that only 15% of the traffic will come out through Kildare and Columbus Road. The traffic study does not acknowledge the shortcut traffic that will run from the South Portland, Spurwink, Hamlin, and Sawyer neighborhoods through Columbus, Oakhurst, and on to Shore Road in Fort Williams. We request that the town hire an independent traffic engineer, not to do a peer review, but to clock real speeds with radar, to develop realistic trip distribution models, and to develop real shortcut models moving traffic from South Portland, Hamlin, over to the Cape Elizabeth Shore Road. Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Ted Darling, and I live at 35 Macaulay Road, and I abut the development right here. I'm not opposed to development, and I'm not opposed to development in my backyard. I am, however, opposed to the size and scope of the proposed development. Like the vast majority of my fellow citizens who responded in a townwide survey relating to the 10-year comprehensive plan, I view the natural environment as a key factor in the quality of my life here in Cape Elizabeth. I do not understand how a 42-unit development concentrated in Spurwink Woods advances the concept of natural environments and thereby improves the quality of my life or the life of my neighbors and fellow citizens in Cape. This development represents a 1.1% increase in total housing stock in Cape Elizabeth, all concentrated within 15 acres of land, if you take out the wetlands. How is this in keeping with the rural character of Cape Elizabeth we all love? I'm particularly concerned about a development of this size and scope, which may alter the character of existing neighborhoods by increasing the daily traffic flows in and out of long-established neighborhoods. Relating to increased traffic flows, I'm concerned about the negative economic impact this development will have on the values of homes in affected neighborhoods. For sale signs already abound on Columbus Road and on Spurrow and Grant Avenue as a result of this proposed project. I'm concerned about the potential town-wide impact of rising taxes as a result of increased strain on town services this large development may have. I'm concerned about a project of this size and scope and the impact it will have on natural environments, including RP1 and RP2 wetlands and Spurwink Woods. Does Cape Elizabeth really need a development of this size and scope? I don't think so. I strongly urge the Planning Board to reject this application based upon the size and scope of this proposed Spurwink Woods project and its impact on existing neighborhoods, on the values of people's homes, on natural environments, including wetlands, and on the citizens' tax burden. But more importantly, I urge rejection of this proposal as to size and scope, as it's out of character with the town-wide desire to preserve the town's rural landscape and rural character. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Peggy Hunter, and I live on 67 Columbus Road. It is on the corner of Kildare and Columbus. The intersection that will, I will actually be on the corner of the intersection that will go into the new neighborhood from Kildare. So I don't know, it's up here somewhere. a lot of people have talked about a lot of technical things, but I'm a mother of four children, and I'm really concerned about the way my life is going to change after this huge development goes in right behind my house. Because of how many houses are going in, because of being connected with all these neighborhoods, because of shortcut traffic, our way of life is going to change. If you allow it at all, our life is going to be impacted with my family, what we do in our free time, the way I spend time with my family. I'm concerned about their safety. I'm concerned about their ability to play sports in the front yard. I'm concerned about our way of life. And I can't speak about the specifics about wetlands, but I can say that if it goes in at all, my life changes. I bought this house because it's the second to the last house on a dead-end road, and I wanted to raise a large family in a safe neighborhood. The way we live now, we have neighbors the same age as my children. I have 5, 6, 7, and 10-year-old. My four kids, that's their ages. We have kids the same age across the street. We have the same kids on the other side of Kildare. They cross that street, they cross in the front. We probably have every day 15 children out in the front and out in our front yard or front yard across the street. And that's going to change. And I think that you need to look at not just the technical aspects, but what this does to our loop road that's the dead end. It's going to, you know, increase the traffic and make our lives a lot different than what we have right now. And I'm completely opposed to this, and I'd like you to stop this development from occurring at all. Thank you.
My name is Dominic Tracy. I formerly lived on Chevers Road, and I currently live on Phillip Road. I don't really have any prepared statements, but I guess I would just like to challenge this. I certainly can't follow some of the excellent rebuttals, and hope that the board would take them. I guess I would like to challenge the air of inevitability that the presenters and really the board seem to be rolling this thing out with. I think that you know, two previous attempts to develop this parcel have gone down the tubes for good reasons. That this is, you know, obviously an environmentally sensitive area. Has serious access issues, I think that was even really reflected in the prices paid for these parcels, you know, by the developers, that this development was indeed a long shot. And I guess I'm not getting that sense from the review of the meeting minutes from the original hearing from the planning board. It seemed to me, I wasn't here, but just in reviewing those meeting minutes, it seemed that you guys lobbed a few softball questions at him and really didn't challenge the very serious issues excuse me, that are being voiced here. You know, as far as responsible development in this same area, in this triangle of Spurwink and 77 and Mitchell Road, there's, you know, the Oaks and Canterbury at the Cape, you know, parcels that have been developed with a single access point that aren't going to fundamentally change the face of Cape Elizabeth for generations to come. I mean, this is it. This whole, creating that cut through, you know, what's that going to look like 100 years from now, 200 years from now? You're fundamentally changing Cape Elizabeth by considering this this development. And I guess just to, setting aside the people here tonight who stand to benefit, you know, financially from this development, just by a show of hands, who is here with serious reservations about this particular development? If we could put our hands up. You have a significant portion of the voting public of Cape Elizabeth here, and the fact that they have come out on, you know, a Tuesday night in the holiday season to, you know, express these concerns, I think that's something that the planning board really needs to take into serious consideration as they consider this application. Thank you.
Planning board members, chair. My name is Sharon O'Neill. I live at 56 Columbus Road. I'm two houses down from Peggy Hunter, who's at 67. My husband, Tim, and I, and our children, have been residents of Cape Elizabeth for 6 years. We relocated from Cumberland. In our search for a home, we sought out the dead-end features we enjoyed in our previous home in Cumberland. We strongly oppose the Spurwink Woods project for the following reasons. First and foremost, we oppose the creation of a through street, which would open up our neighborhood to non-local traffic. Creation of 42 homes alone will increase the traffic in our neighborhood significantly, without the addition of unforeseen traffic once the Spurwink Woods development connects Spurwink Road to Mitchell Road. We are especially concerned that Columbus Road will turn into a speedway. It is a wide and straight road and appealing to someone trying to make up time after having to wind through Spurwink Woods to make their way to Mitchell. Secondly, we are strongly opposed to the size of the development. We, the residents of Columbus, Kildare, and Thrasher, currently live in a quiet neighborhood. The roads on Kildare and Thrasher are narrow, and wintertime is especially hard for larger vehicles, such as the school bus, to round the corner if there are any vehicles parked along those roads. Add to that cars trying to pull out at the corner of Kildare. And I guess I just want to add also quickly, even though it's been mentioned before, that Columbus, Thrasher, and Kildare are predominantly made up of two-car, two-income families. So as far as the traffic study goes, I guess I was a little confused by that, but I just wanted to add that in there as a little side piece. There's also the concern of the loss of quiet enjoyment of all the surrounding neighborhoods as construction of the 42-lot subdivision drags on for years. There will be blasting and heavy equipment not only traveling through our streets, but in use perhaps 5 days a week for roughly 3 to 5 years. If this project is going to move forward, we insist that serious consideration be given to implementing an emergency access gate or device for this project. Whether it goes at one end or in the middle, this would eliminate the issue of a through street and ease our concerns of non-local excess of the traffic. We also feel that this project needs to be downsized. Building 42 homes and condos does not fit into the existing natural environment and rural character of any of the surrounding neighborhoods. And finally, we insist on some safety measures for pedestrian traffic. Many neighbors walk, some with pets, in our neighborhood at night. We believe more street lights, especially where there are currently none, sidewalks, stop signs at all intersections, and posted 15-mile-an-hour speed limit signs should be added. And I'm also going to reiterate the current comprehensive plan survey, which basically said that Cape residents like the town the way it is. Thank you for your time.
My name is Joseph Jones. I live at 46 Columbus Road. I may be the newest resident here in this room. I moved into Columbus Road July 20th of this year. I've been to 48 states. I've been to 15 countries. There is no place I would rather live than Maine. There's no town I would rather live than Cape Elizabeth. There is no neighborhood I would rather live in than the neighborhood I live in. And I don't see, for the life of me, why people in my neighborhood and the people on Mitchell Road should subsidize what comes down to a deep-pocket developer's business enterprise with our inconvenience, with the denigration of our property, and with a concrete and macadam sprawl that will befall all of us. I think that sometimes when you move into a new area, you see things with new eyes. I have a degree as a photographer. I did photography for many years. And I know that when you go to a place, you see things freshly. You can tell by the work that you do if you take pictures. I think Mitchell Road is a real treasure. I think it just screams out, this is New England. You got the little salt box houses there. You have the Cape Cods. You have the twisty little road lined with trees. You have, you have some of the McMansions there, and you have some of the old three-season cottages that have been converted into four-season houses. But to me, it's beautiful. It's the only place I would rather be. I guess I worked for a Greek one time who happened to be a developer. He left the country facing some felony charges, but... I did learn one thing from this man. He was an old man. He used to like to speak in parables. And he said that, in his village, there was a wealthy man, well-dressed, diamond stick pin, snake wood cane, silver handle. And he dressed in a Homburg and walked down to the village square swinging his cane. Two steps, he'd swing the cane. Another two steps, he'd twirl the cane. And one day, he hit a guy in the nose, broke his nose. Well, a civil suit ensued because of that. The judge asked the man who's the plaintiff what happened. He said, I was minding my own business, and that man broke my nose. And he asked the defendant what happened. He said, I've been going to the marketplace every week for as long as I can remember. Everybody knows me. I have a right to swing my cane. And the judge says, you do indeed, but I'm going to rule for the plaintiff because your rights end where that man's nose begins. Amen. So that's the way I feel about it, and I can't look at charts and I can't look at maps without my head spinning, but I don't care if these developers make money. If they do, fine. If they don't, fine. But don't ask me to subsidize it. And if this project does go through, I hope their kids come home from school with head lice. Thank you.
If I could just 1 minute, if I could just interject, I'm just trying to get a sense of how many people are still waiting to speak. I know we have three in the queue and about a half a dozen more. Okay. I was planning to summarize the issues that have been raised to date. You're certainly welcome to highlight them again, especially if you have something new to add. But given that we only have six or so people left, just proceed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Ron Hopple, and I own property in the town of Cape Elizabeth, and that's a pretty hard act to follow. I would like to say also that what I have to say is at the risk of not making it out the door. I've listened to the claps, and I understand it. I don't live adjacent to this property, so I understand what's going on emotionally. But I think this project requires or should have some positive look by this planning group. And I have three reasons for saying that. One is that I believe it will, if I understand the calculations correctly, and I didn't do them, I think that it will have a positive physical impact on the city. And heavens knows we need tax relief here. We're driving people out of this town with the taxes. Secondly, I think it does, contrary to what some people feel, offers diversity of housing. This is a pretty monolithic, in many respects, place to live when it comes to housing. And lastly, I think it also, with that diversity of housing, offers a potential of providing some affordable housing, particularly for, well, providable, affordable in some respects, to some, maybe to, even to some people who are employees of this town. And I thank you for hearing me out. Please.
Thank you.
That guy's going to get head lice. My name is Richard Berman. I live at 58 Hannaford Cove Road. So I don't live adjacent to this. And therefore, I don't know the details the way a lot of people do. And I know this board doesn't deal with public policy, that, you know, if the land is zoned so, you've got to follow the rules and look at all the details. And I do have a lot of, confidence in the planning staff and the planning board. I haven't seen a project in Cape Elizabeth since I've been living here that ever got approved that was a piece of, that wasn't good, that wasn't executed well. So I think you guys do a good job. I would like to tell you conceptually what I like about this, trying to stay positive. And this is at a risk of a lot of friends who live in the neighborhood, but and I don't think I'll get head lice. But what I like is interconnected streets. By the way, I also am a member of Grow Smart Maine, and I'm involved in growth and interested in it. Interconnected streets make a whole lot of sense. It really does disperse traffic. And again, I'll bow to the more expert people, but I think that the people in the neighborhood will have different ways of getting out. But I myself drive around there, and I don't see it as a cut-through. I would never go through all this mishigosh when I can go right up the street and cut over on some more popular streets. So I don't know if that's an issue, but again, what I like about it is interconnected streets. I like also the idea of diversity, that these lots that I'm hearing about are small, that there won't be McMansions, at least, on them, and that there will be diversity. I like the fact that there's some hope for the elderly. I have a lot of friends who are looking for condominiums my age, and there's not a lot of product in Cape Elizabeth, so I think it could help that way also. I heard about the positive economic impact, and I think that is important in this town when we have a lot of people who are on the edge, especially the elderly. I also like that they're local developers, that they're part of our community. They're, you know, the kids go to school here, they serve at the churches here. This is we're talking all neighbors here. And the other thing I like is they have good professionals. When you talk about traffic, Gurl Palmer is the best in the state, as well as civil engineering. I don't know about wetlands and different things, but I know that some of the people I've heard really are good professionals and do a very good job. And so if you're going to get any peer review, I think you're wasting your money, but, you know, that's up to you. John Mitchell has been in this town doing landscape architecture for many years. And so anyway, they have a very good, Al Palmer, they have a very good team put together. I myself have conflict. Anytime I see growth, I have conflict. I moved to Cape Elizabeth. I took some open space and I built a house. Now I'd like to roll up the carpet and let nobody else in. But somehow, that doesn't feel right to me. People have property rights. I believe in good growth. and managed growth. And I just look at, I moved to here in 1970, Portland. If you remember Portland in 1970, I think it's a lot better now. And it's because of growth. I think that if we, this rural character I've heard about, I have to laugh about a little bit, which I think the Land Trust and the Conservation Commission is doing a great job in this town, and I think everybody wants to keep as much of the open space as we can. But also we need to grow our neighborhoods. And the interconnected streets, from a smart growth standpoint, these types of projects make sense because they're expanding on existing neighborhoods. It's using infrastructure. It's creating connectivity. And that's the kind of growth that we want, is more infill development rather than creating new developments in open fields, for instance. So, again, I can't speak to the specifics of this. I'm very sensitive to everybody whose neighborhood and is affected by growth. But that is growth. And it's sort of, we grow or die. I think the trick is to do it right. I think there's a lot of good things about this project, and I think I have the confidence in the board and the staff to make sure that this is done right at the right density in dealing with all the safety and environmental issues that you are dealing with. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for letting us have this so we can state our opinions. My name is Diane Nicholson. I actually live on Mitchell Road. I am opposed to Spurwink Woods development. I grew up on Columbus Road. My husband grew up on Stevenson. Our mothers both still live on in their respective houses. We live close enough to Columbus that, living on Mitchell Road, even though my children are a little bit older, I still can't let them ride their bikes extensively on Mitchell Road. They're old enough that I let them ride their bikes from our house on Mitchell Road to Columbus, where then I feel they can ride around Columbus Road and have some safety, not have so much traffic. For us, it's one of the only safe, close neighborhoods that my kids can go there and play in. Of course, my mother lives there, so my kids can go and play in the neighborhood and have friends there and do those things. I'm concerned about the increased traffic. I'm concerned about the speed of that traffic that we'll be going through. I'm concerned about property values of my mother's house and my mother-in-law's house. I am concerned about all of the neighbors who chose to live in these two dead-end neighborhoods. Some moved in, and I actually just wrote this 4 months, and I think someone said they just moved in 4 months ago, but I didn't know that. But others moved there 40 years ago, and they didn't choose to live on Mitchell Road or Spurwink Road or 77. They chose dead-end neighborhoods, and I really hope that you can try to respect that in some way. Mostly, I'm concerned for the wooded area that will be destroyed. In our end of town, there are very few spaces like that where we can go into the woods, we can walk to and go into the woods and walk around and not really see houses and have, you know, wave to somebody on their back deck, which what it sounds like it's going to turn into. The other thing I wanted to bring up, and other people have referenced it, is the Comprehensive Planning Committee has come up just this month, the summary report of the poll, the telephone poll. I just recently read this. I could go through and quote almost off every page of what is important to the citizens of this town in respect to this project. I encourage any of you who haven't looked at it to please look at it. I'll give you my copy if you'd like it. But throughout the document, it talks about the importance of town citizens in preserving the rural character of CAPE. One-third of the respondents, and I'm just going to quote a little bit of it, one-third of the respondents said that the rural character of our town meant conserving and preserving open or green space within our town. Another one-third said preserving rural character meant limiting development in town. That's two-thirds of those surveyed that specifically stated those things. According to the report, more than 8 out of 10 residents indicated that protecting and preserving the wetlands, ponds, and wooded areas are important to the 5 to 10 year goals for our town. I could go on and I could go through it and I could come up with more, but I just, like I said, I encourage you all to read it and maybe just slow this project down so you can either wait and find out what the comprehensive plan is going to look like or just find out more about what the citizens of this town are looking for, because based on this, it's not a huge development like that. The other thing, which I wrote down a couple of notes in listening to other people in front of me, interconnectivity is great, but connect Columbus with Chevres. Don't connect it to something that's going to cut all that cut through traffic. And then I've also heard a couple of people saying that, oh, the economic impact this is going to have on our town is going to bring in taxes. These houses are going to attract young families, which means more students in our schools. Our schools are full, and we're having a hard time with our budgets as it is. So I know there has to be development, but this size, bringing in this many young families, really concerns me. I have three children, and they're nowhere near close to being done, and this is going to impact their education if this goes in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Susan Osborne. I live on 33 Columbus Road. I've lived there for over 30 years. We were talking about the property values of the people who live in these neighborhoods. A few people who were in favor of this project said, well, it might bring economic diversity because there are no mansions. Well, I don't know about Stevenson's, but Columbus Road and Thrasher and Kildare are diverse. We don't have mansions. They're very middle-class, middle-priced houses. And, we didn't live in the developments where we could buy 3, 4, 5 acres to, you know, kind of protect our privacy, preserve some woods. So we kind of bought what we did and kind of looked to the planning board and the plan of the town to kind of protect our values. And somebody gave me this ad, and this is a real estate ad from McFarland Real Estate. And a lot of these houses are advertised as quiet street, dead end neighborhood. And that shows that even the real estate developers and the brokers, this is what they put value to. I mean, our houses on Columbus Road, the houses themselves are nothing special. They're built in, you know, the 60s, just split levels and ranches. But the value is Columbus Road. People know of our street. It's a desirable place to live. And that protects our property values, and it distinguishes us from other neighborhoods with similar, just average type houses.
Members of the board, I'm Jay Stackhouse. I live on Woodland Road. I'm not close to this project. I would be seeking something of this nature when I repurchase a home. I've had two homes in Cape Elizabeth, both in neighborhoods. I like neighborhood living. I like to commit with my fellow neighbors. I'm really sorry that maybe the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust didn't do something with this piece of property, but that's not the issue. I like to see some growth. I'm glad I'm not up there and in your shoes, but I do think that we have three family individuals who will work with you folks and the rest of us to make this project viable to the Cape Elizabeth community, whether it's this way or another altered way. But I support some kind of housing so that I don't have to mow a yard all the time. I like to have something simple, and this type of housing is simple. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Allison Darling. I live on 35 Macaulay Road. Spurring Woods, it's gonna be a great neighborhood for those who live there. It'll be easy to travel in and out of the neighborhood. There are great buffers, as has been pointed out by the developers, between the condos and the houses. But for my situation, I live right here.
I have maybe 5 feet between my house and my neighbor's homes in this road. They mentioned putting in evergreens. I don't know necessarily if that's enough. I propose that the road actually be moved further into the development. Sure, that may take up some of their space, but I think that's probably the right neighborly thing to do. This development will directly affect my property value for up to 8 years after the building starts. I'm 44 now. I'll be 52 by the time it's done. That's 8 years of listening to blasting, trucks, workers, and hammers hammering away. There's a development back there now, and believe it or not, it's a little further back. This development back here, we can hear it. We heard it all last summer when it was going up. It made a difference to our peace and quiet. How does this development fit into the recent study of what the town really wants? I know everybody's mentioned the study this evening. The Comprehensive Planning Committee found that the preservation of the town's natural landscape, rural character, and farmland are its highest priority. How can the size of this development really fit into what the town's looking for? I urge you to please consider limiting the size of this development and consider moving that road. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mike Willett. I live at 7 Hamblin Street, and I don't want to be too redundant. I just want to address again that living there the short time, that Spurwink is a dangerous corner, and it needs to be addressed without cutting down trees and other vegetation. The second issue is that the town really needs to consider doing something with South Street and the remainder of Stevenson Street. That's got to be brought up to par to address the traffic flow if the subdivision goes through. Number three, are sidewalks. You required my developer to put them in. They sound nice. They sound sexy. My wife was sold on them, too. But the last snowstorm, there's 10 inches on them. They're unusable. And so I don't know whose idea it is to maintain, or whose responsibility it is to maintain them. You can argue that these houses here, but what about they go up and around? Who's going to maintain them? That's just something you have to consider. If they're not going to be used, then you're going to have pedestrians out in the street. And the fourth thing, I don't know if it's been brought up before, but it seems kind of logical. If you scale this down and you split the difference, why doesn't Chicory Way run into here and then this become a dead-end cul-de-sac? You split the difference. And then you use this connector for a playground. That's my idea of connectivity, not a throughway.
Good evening. My name is Rob Carlson. I live at 19 Kildare Road, which on the map is right here. I actually kind of cut into the development itself. I will not be redundant. I agree with most of the comments made tonight. Very well thought out comments. I just want to mention a couple things that haven't been brought up yet in concerns to my property and some on my side of Kildare Road. In particular, there's a small hill here. We get a lot of drainage that actually comes down off of Kildare and spill into these neighborhoods currently. I have a standing water in my yard half the year, in the back of my yard. It's a small river in between myself and my neighbor that's behind me. That would be right around here. That diverts water away from my yard, etc. And I just have concerns over stormwater drainage in particular. They mentioned areas down here, over here, and I believe over here. I haven't heard of anything in my area itself, and I have brought this up in the past as well. I have a very small home, probably one of the smallest in the neighborhood. I do have concerns over property values moving forward, as well as my house being one of the older houses in the neighborhood. I have concerns over the blasting that will have to happen, etc., and so in concerns to foundations, etc. There was a comment made a little bit earlier today that we've got some very family-oriented and local people doing the development, and I hope that they will work with us as a neighborhood, and if they've heard the comments tonight, I'm sure that some of the plans that have been proposed may change. I certainly have no issue with development in the town. I think that the scale and size of this development is simply too big. The truth of the matter is we will lose the fabric that and the character of the neighborhood, which is the whole reason why I bought my house and am raising a family there. So thank you for your listening tonight.
Good evening. My name is Jerry Anger, and I am an abutting neighbor, I believe, to this complex. I live over in Canterbury, which is somewhere over in here, which is the condominium complex on the other side from the current neighborhood. I'd like to thank the board personally for planning this meeting tonight and scheduling it, because otherwise I would be home doing gift wrapping, because I have been nagged all week. Have you done your gift wrapping? And I suspect many of you are here taking a break from doing the same thing. So thank you, Mr. Chair. I had the opportunity to review this plan because it was in the front page of the Courier. Now, you really can do that with the help of a magnifying glass. And I thought it was very interesting. I have been a recipient of the phone call for the comprehensive plan, and I thought it was very well put together, very well thought out, and I appreciated being one of the 400 residents, I believe, that had the opportunity to address those questions. I, too, like open space and preserving that, and I think we have the opportunity and the vehicle here in Cape Elizabeth with the land trust to be able to do that. Unfortunately, the land trust does not own this property. This is private property, private development. The other thing I have learned in my 60-plus years of living is that the only constant we have in our world is change, and unfortunately, that's the way it is. These gentlemen are, I believe, long-term Cape residents for many, many years. I myself have lived here for 22 years, and I would go back and reflect on a neighborhood that I used to live in before I moved to Canterbury, and that was over in the Brentwood West area. And up the road, up the hill, was a 90-unit development that some of you may have been involved with called Cross Hill. Cross Hill has a road that comes across through the Cross Hill development. That might be called by some a connector road. I don't think that there's a lot of through traffic on that road going from one side to the other. The traffic study, I think, is valid. I liked what I heard tonight, and there may be some tweaking, conceivably, that you folks would request the developers to do, and that may very well make some sense. I also like the good use of the neighborhood concept, curved streets, traffic calming, and planning. A lady said that she lived in this area, I'm not sure which house it is, but my guess is, and not having read the Cape Planning Code ordinances, that there's probably more than 5 feet between her land and the abutting land that these folks have here. Somebody, I think, in more than one occasion has mentioned a 2- or 3-way possible stop sign on Spurwink, using that street periodically. That might make some sense going forward. Living in a condominium association with 32 units, I would suggest to you that my wife and I are one of the few people that have in that complex, we're worker bees. Both of us work. Many retirees live there. Many are in Florida. My next door neighbor left yesterday to go to Florida. I won't see him again until May. I suspect with the condominium complex, such as we have here and such as being proposed, that many of those folks are not going to be here for part of the time during the year. The last thing I would share with you is that, yes, we're dealing with private property, and yes, we're dealing with ordinances. I had the opportunity, the great pleasure, and the challenge to sit where you have, where you are now, for 8 years on the South Portland Planning Board before moving to Cape Elizabeth 22 years ago. I also had the opportunity to sit exactly where you sit because I was a provisional member of this planning board a number of years ago for a year. So I know what your challenges are, I understand what you're up to, and I think if I had had the opportunity in sitting where you are or sitting in my 8 years in South Portland, I would have been delighted to have seen a complex like this come before me, and knowing what's gone before and what I've heard tonight, there's a lot of homework, and there may still be some homework yet to do, but I think these folks have done a crackerjack job, and I'm looking forward to having them as my neighbors. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to speak. My name's Howard Fisher, and I live off Macaulay. I'm not involved in the neighborhood of Columbus, but living on Macaulay, my biggest concern is that S-curve on Mitchell, and I have heard no one address that tonight. That's a dangerous section of the street, and if you don't think it's dangerous, my neighborhood has maybe 20 houses in it, and I know two people that have been hit by vehicles on that street in the last year and a half, and I haven't heard that mentioned here. There are no curbs, there are no shoulders, there are no sidewalks. And if you're going to allow that amount of traffic to flow down through Columbus, you're going to have to do something with that part of Mitchell. And if you think that 20 empty nesters aren't going to come down through Columbus, turn left and a blind S-curve, go down to Oakhurst to go to Fort Williams, you don't understand what's going on in that neighborhood or what Fort Williams is all about. So you better take a look at the traffic flow a little bit closer, and not just on Killdeer, but take a look at that S-curve on Mitchell. Thank you.
Hi. My name's Julia Orr, and I live on 20 Chevres Road, which is parallel to Columbus. Saying goodbye to the woods will be like saying goodbye to an old friend. True, their fate has not yet been decided. There are more meetings, more discussions, more compromises. When I first heard the news about the proposed development, I was stunned. I had foolishly taken it for granted that this land belonged to the town and was protected. I've spent the last 8 years walking in those woods, enjoying those woods, loving those woods. It's been a very beautiful place. It is a beautiful place to be. And it hurts to visit them now. I felt like I knew the news about the wood's fate, but the woods do not know. The old pines still sway in the wind. The sunlight still streams through the branches of the trees. And the cardinals are still singing. Truly, it's hard to describe the beauty of this land. My words do not do this verdant landscape justice. It is a spiritual place in which we can go to gain strength and to feel renewed when we go there. It is a sanctuary. If this land is developed, I want to tell it that I'm sorry. Sorry that I'm not rich enough to buy it and protect it. Sorry to the animals that find their homes there. Sorry to the trees that can soon be cut down. Sorry to the people who may not have a chance to enjoy it. And sorry, yes, sorry for me and my neighbors who will have to listen to the trucks, the blasting, the cutting that will most likely go on for years. This little neighborhood will never be the same. If the development is approved, the death sentence has been given. Thank you.
There's nobody left in the queue. Does anybody else wish to speak before we conclude the public hearing? Okay, with that, I will conclude the public hearing. At this point, recognizing it is a little late, but we, our charge at this point is to begin our substantive review of the application. And I know there are a lot of issues that have been raised in the public hearing, and I thank you all for coming out tonight on December 20th. I'm not sure this is a good enough reason not to be gift wrapping, but no, it clearly is. But in any event, I do thank you all for your comments, and you've raised a lot of valid issues and concerns. At this point, I would turn it over to fellow members of the board. Barbara.
I have a lot of questions about the traffic, and I don't even know where to begin, because the numbers that I heard I'd like to go back over the numbers for the traffic, because they don't add up, at least not on the surface to me, about how many cars there are going to be. I would like to have the person who reviewed the traffic study appear before us to answer questions the next time. I just think there are an awful lot of things about the traffic that are very important to go over.
The gentleman who conducted the peer review study is not here this evening. I had the same thought, Barbara, as I was going through all of the materials, that we should have invited him here tonight, but we could invite him here for the next time we gather to discuss this application.
And it should be noted that that's not part of the contract, so, you know, certainly you can have him here, but that's why he's not here tonight. And I will contact him and see if he's available for the January meeting.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know if you want to start now with asking questions about the traffic, because they're pretty detailed, and I think Paul can probably shed some light on some of it for us.
And I just also want to get a sense of where the board is globally. I mean, obviously, there are a ton of issues, but I'm also suspecting that a likely outcome tonight is that this may be tabled until the January meeting, simply because some plans are continuing to work on in conjunction with the town planner, the DEP, et cetera.
We don't have the stormwater.
Right. That's the main one that is likely to cause this to be tabled. Is the board of that general sentiment? I mean, I still think we should try to do some review tonight to get some of the issues out, but do we have another application pending before us, by the way?
Yep.
Okay.
But the applicant for the next project is going to be here for this project, so.
Okay. Right. So that's not an issue then?
Perhaps, I mean, I understand that there's a lot of issues, and the applicant needs to be sent back to work on some issues. Perhaps there's an issue or several that, in particular, the applicant would like to have some discussion on to give you some direction. Would that assist you?
Sure. Just one global issue that was raised again and again and again was too intense for the area, too many houses, too many units. It might be helpful if people would understand what the alternative is. To this particular plan, and I don't know if that's something that the town planner could give us some background on, if you would.
The project is in the RC district. The minimum lot size in the RC district is 20,000 square feet, and if a traditional subdivision were designed for the project, significantly less open space would be preserved as part of the development. And in fact, the applicant originally came in with a design that was what I would consider to be a traditional subdivision. All of the open space that you see in the middle of the project was gone. All the open space on the edges were gone. There were no trail connections. I advised the applicant, and I think I spoke to the board about this, that the board was strongly supportive of the concept of the open space zoning provisions in our zoning ordinance, directed the applicant that they should really take a new approach, a completely new approach, that looked at using the open space zoning provisions. The open space zoning provisions require that 40% of the gross area of the land be set aside as open space. It also requires that the lot sizes be a lot smaller. There's a mandatory requirement that the lots have to be smaller. It forces applicants to create smaller lots because there's a maximum average lot size that they have to comply with. So these lots are smaller because the applicant has complied with the open space zoning provisions. In the past, the planning board and the town's support of the open space zoning provisions is in large part due to the desire to preserve the rural character of the town. When you create smaller lots, you provide an opportunity for a landowner to still get a fair financial return on their property while at the same time preserving a large amount of open space. And the open space is preserved in large chunks. It's not just in border areas. The open space zoning provisions specifically state that the planning board is supposed to review the open space zoning to make sure you are achieving those objectives, that you're not just getting narrow strips here and there. And finally, while I know this is not something that people like to hear, the town of Cape Elizabeth builds approximately 30 new homes a year. We can put half of the homes here, and then we have to find another property somewhere else in Cape Elizabeth that will likely be developed for those other homes. So if we provide most of, if we put 42 homes in this property, that means that there's other land in Cape Elizabeth that will not be developed in the foreseeable future. We're just, despite the number of lots that have been approved in the town, for example, the 97 lots in Cross Hill, the 17 lots in Hemlock Hill, we're still issuing just about 30 building permits a year. It's been an extremely steady growth rate for almost 15 years. So if we can put 42 units here, that's a year and a half worth of growth in one lot that will preserve more open space in other parts of town. And these are all part of the reasons that you go and work on this open space zoning concept instead of a traditional subdivision concept, which would create larger lots. It would have a lot less open space preserved.
So if there were a traditional subdivision plan for this area, about how many, which would mean there wouldn't be much, if any, open space preserved.
There would be some, because there is an open space zoning standard in the subdivision ordinance that requires a certain amount of square footage that has to be set aside per unit. And that square footage is based on the amount of open space that's already preserved in the town. But it would be less than this.
How many, approximately?
I would have to ask the applicant to calculate that, or I'd have to calculate. I'd have to get back to you with that.
All right. Okay. I'm just trying to see if not only the board but the public here could have an understanding as to if this cluster development were not pursued and a traditional subdivision were pursued instead, how many lots would we be talking about?
There would be fewer lots, and I would ask the applicant if they could perhaps bring one of the older plans for the next meeting. I can tell you, though, that the idea of preserving the woods, the major areas that we're still able to preserve on this project are right in that center area. Once you get past that point, you really start going downhill into the wetland area. The major amount of wetland preservation is in that central area. That's all gone with the other proposal. So you would be able to preserve the wetland and not that much more. But I'm going to let the plan speak to you when you see it.
I'm not advocating that. I just, because the issue was raised so many times by the abutters, I thought it would be helpful background for them to know. John.
In looking at this project, one of the things that I need to have more information on and need to be convinced on is the idea of a connectivity in the sense that in reality, isn't this a project that doesn't have access? I mean, isn't this like a project being built in the middle of land owned by someone else and there's no access to it? And by allowing a dead-end street to be changed to a through street and connecting streets, we are providing access where none is there now. Now, we don't always do that. We certainly don't do that when private land is involved and there may not be streets going through. And so I see that a little differently. And if we're going to do that, I have to be convinced that we are doing it fairly and we're doing it in a way that benefits or at least doesn't harm the neighborhoods that we are creating the connection with, that we are providing the access through where none is there now. And one of the things I would ask is that there has been a lot of discussion about cut through traffic, but I frankly didn't hear any information from the developer side in terms of any data as to how much traffic that would be and what that information is based on. I'm not a traffic engineer. I don't know how one would determine that other than speculating, but there must be a way. And it may not be a significant impact, it may not be a significant issue. I don't know, but I really didn't hear the information come out one way or the other in terms of how much of an issue that would be or if it's going to be an issue at all. But in looking at this, that's how I see it. We're creating access to a development where none exists. And by doing that, we have to weigh a lot of different considerations.
Jack?
I share the same concerns that Barbara and John had. And those concerns are amplified by some confusion I have based on the traffic studies, the way they're presented tonight. We were told 41 trip ends in the AM and 51 trip ends in the PM. This development of 42 houses, the standard that I'm accustomed to hearing is 10 trips per day per house. And you presented numbers which are about 20% of that. And so that leaves me somewhat confused about how you defend that, I mean, being 20% of what's about the normal standard. And I also have not seen or heard any evidence that the traffic study has given any credence to the neighbors' concerns about cut-through traffic. So we're hearing two different sides of the story. And my feeling is that traffic study by the developer is basically ignoring things rather than examining things and providing a rational, objective look at things.
We're kind of raising a lot of issues. Would the applicant like to address some of the concerns raised so far with regard to the traffic study? Okay.
I would like to share it.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, again, my name is Tom Gorl. There seems to be certainly a bit of confusion about the trip generation, and the trip generation that we used in the study is derived from a publication called the Institute of Transportation Engineers Trip Generation. It's what we use for all our traffic studies. It's really the standard that is required typically to be utilized. It's based on a lot of studies across the nation, including Maine, as to what different types of developments generate. The development that will generate the land use, if you will, that generates the most traffic is a single family home, as opposed to a condominium. We assumed these units would all be single family homes from a trip generation standpoint. The numbers, as I went through them with you, we said that the AM peak hour would generate 41 trip ends, a trip end being either an in or an out, and 51 PM peak hour trip ends. So those are one, basically more than one per unit. And that is the standard that is utilized. And it's actually pretty similar to what we got in counting the overall neighborhood. So the trip generation, I'm very comfortable with. That is the standard.
How would that translate to a per day?
Per day, it would be approximately 460 to 470 trip ends. Trip
so
ends
that
in an hour.
Per household?
Per house, that gets closer to the what he was referring to was really a daily standard, that the old standard was 10 trip ends per unit, if you will, for a day, not an hour.
Lori.
Tom, could you just take a minute to explain why you're focusing, what is peak hour, and why you're focusing on peak hour versus daily traffic load?
Certainly can. And the traffic engineers use most of the time peak hours. Similar, I'll relate it to probably drainage, is somewhat similar in that you look at the peak flow through the pipe. Well, the peak that we look at as traffic engineers is the peak hour. If that hour works, then the rest of the hours are obviously going to work. All the national standards in terms of evaluating capacity are based upon peak hour generation. So that is why we use that, a daily volume in terms of it's useful, but in terms of evaluating capacity, that the benchmark for all that is always done during a peak hour, just as it would be the peak event for drainage.
Barbara.
What is confusing me, you held up the, it's down on the floor, a chart showing, it was very hard to read.
Sure.
How many cars were coming out of Mitchell and Columbus at a peak hour, and there were very few, and yet we're talking about 41 and 51, and how many were going out of, mm-hmm. of Stevenson and Hamlin, and they were very few, too. And so I didn't know what happened to all the traffic.
This is actually a figure number 7 that's contained in the traffic impact study that we submitted.
Well, I read it all, but I can't.
Well, gee, that's pretty good if you did that.
I tried.
And what you end up doing here, if you go through and add up the trip ends, so in other words, down here, for instance, at Mitchell Road, there's 3 trip ends exiting. There's 3 entering on the right, and there's 2 turning left. So that's 5. That's 8 total at that location out of the 51 that we had there.
Well, in my head, quickly, I couldn't come up with anywhere near 51 because there are really only 2 entrances and exits. There's the one on Mitchell, and there's the one on Stevenson and
right. And then
Hamlin. If, the rest are irrelevant. They're internal.
Sure. Well, if we take the other point down in here, and we take the 18 that's in the 10, we have 28, and then we've got another 10, which is 38. We have, are you okay?
Yeah.
Okay, 43, and then we add in the 8 to get the 51. So that's how the numbers end. Again, the key that you do need to remember is that these are our trip ends. So there's a tendency to think of, you know, the 42 units, and it sounds like a lot of traffic. It is trip ends, and it's distributed. That's one of the issues here is you get it distributed on the roadway, both between ins and outs and such, and it's really not that much traffic. These are actually, again, hourly volumes.
Of course, that counts for no cut through at all.
Yeah, and that's what I was saying earlier. And there was a question relative to the cut-through traffic, and we can attempt to quantify that. It is difficult.
How?
Perfectly.
How do you quantify?
That's where I was coming to. It's very difficult to say for sure what goes through there. We look at the street patterns around it to try to come up with that. We also look at existing street volumes that we have during, you know, various times. So that we'd know what the order of magnitude we're talking about would be anyway. And we could go back and do that. But at the same time, what we were emphasizing...
So what you just said is you can look at the amount of traffic around that area.
Yep.
Look at the patterns in terms of where cars may turn.
Right.
But beyond that, you don't know if they're going to then use a road that's not there as of yet.
With certainty, that's pretty hard to tell, but we can certainly go through and try to make an estimate, I think. We don't believe it would be a lot. The peer review obviously concurred with that. But what we are trying...
And what did you base that conclusion on, that it wouldn't be a lot?
As we presented her here in terms of how we were getting to various places around here, and I did hear this was one analysis that really showed us there'd be almost none for the work trip, if you will, heading toward Portland. There were other questions here tonight about traffic that wanted to go down, for instance, Spurwink into the mall, I think they were indicating. We certainly can take a similar analysis of that route as well to, you know, reach a conclusion relative to that.
So you make assumptions about where someone may be going.
Yes.
From one side to the other.
Correct.
And then you, based on that assumption, try to estimate which way they would go to get there.
Based upon distances, travel times, which take into consideration the number.
Yeah, and assuming the shorter they would use the shorter distances.
Not necessarily. No, that's not true.
Then what do you use?
It's, as I mentioned, travel time is an important element in there as well. Certainly the number of stop signs, the number of signals that you have in this analysis, we had looked at all of that in terms of the number of stop signs that you have going up different routes. And I can go through that, but it's rather detailed. We can do that same thing, however, because every time that you've got to stop at stoplights and stop signs, that's going to increase your travel time. So that's another aspect in going through the analysis that we look at.
Okay, but again, how much of this have you already done to make an estimate of how many cars might use this cut through or not? I know you can do it. What has been done, and what's the conclusions that you've reached based on what you've done?
Our conclusion was we didn't see a lot of it. We didn't quantify it. Again, it's difficult to do that. We can go back to try to put a number to it, but that is difficult to do. We don't see, a large number of people doing that. But again, I'll try to go back and put a number to that if that's certainly something you're requesting.
I think some of the commentators here tonight, both at the hearing and also in emails and letters, have said, well, you focus perhaps too much on the workplace destination, and it would be very helpful for us for you to do the analysis in terms of people who might be going to Fort Williams or the baseball fields or other destinations within our vicinity that may cause them to use this neighborhood as a potential cut-through.
Right, and that's what I wrote down in my notes, to go through a very similar analysis as to what was contained in the report, where we, cataloged the number of stop signs and the number of signals and the distances and all that sort of thing. That's really what we need to go through in terms of the other routes that or other destinations that were requested.
Paul?
Mr. Chairman, my fellow board members, as a professional traffic engineer, first and foremost, I understand that there is going to be an impact on the neighborhoods from the fact that just simply due to the development itself, there will be additional traffic through these neighborhoods. The task for Tom or our peer review person to quantify cut-through traffic is a difficult one. I concur with everybody that it hasn't been quantified. I think there's an opportunity for the applicant to look at this more and perhaps, maybe provide a better understanding of the potential. But really my focus in this, if this proposed development is to move forward, is really to look at an opportunity to eliminate as much as possible cut-through traffic, and I think that can be done in many positive ways. John, you aptly noted that, again, we're providing access where there is none today, so those people who would live there need to get there. But are there things that can be done as part of this proposed development to, again, eliminate as much as possible cut-through traffic that, might consider doing this? And there are a variety of methods that are available, today, whether it be sidewalks, whether it be, speed humps, so on and so forth. But I think that type of positive approach to this development, I think, needs to be shown in the plans. I'm also very concerned and focused on the safety of this. We have a couple of intersections that, in my professional opinion, are ones that I'm very, very concerned about, the intersection of Stevenson and Spurwink. It's not the volume of traffic, but it's more the safety of it and having the proper site distance and being able to accommodate, again, what is going to be an increase in traffic to whatever degree and making sure that it's safely handled. So from my perspective, Mr. Chair, those are the things that I'm very focused on. Again, I encourage the applicant to take a very hard look at traffic because it certainly is a very emotional and very real issue for folks who are going to be living in those neighborhoods. And again, whatever measures can be made to reduce that number to as low a number as possible, I think is something that we'd all be interested in seeing.
Barbara?
Well, I have lots of things that I am concerned about. One of them is South Street. And the fact that that's not being considered. And I understand the legal problems in terms of title, but I think that's really a big negative to this project, is that the traffic is not flowing, in my mind, all that well. I'm also concerned about the access and what John brought up, because there are some questions in my mind about providing access through an existing neighborhood, and whether or not that's permissible or not permissible by tacking on a lot the way it's been tacked on. But Maureen, what are the regulations, and I can't remember, what length can't a road exceed before you need an entrance and an egress?
2,000 feet.
And how long is this road?
Well, I believe that the Hamlin Street subdivision on the one end was pushing 1,000 feet. So you run out of, it's 2,000 feet and 20 homes. So either way in, you run out of number of homes long before you get to the project.
It counts Hamlin Street too then.
Right, yeah. You have to count from the point where only one means of access exists. So on one end, it's the intersection of Spurwink and Stevenson. And on the other end, it's the intersection of Mitchell and Columbus. And those are the two places where you have to start measuring length of road and number of homes. And obviously on the Columbus end, you run out of homes very quickly. On the Stevenson end, I think you're at about 1,000 feet when you get to the end of Hamlin Street, but you're almost at the end of 20 homes as well. So, it's our own ordinances that have pushed this applicant into this approach. They do have frontage on Spurwink Ave, and there have been previous attempts by prior owners to gain access for project through Spurwink Ave. But we have an RP1 wetland that is in the way, and our wetlands regulations prohibit access through that wetland.
I'd just like to echo those comments on the South Street issue. I have the similar concern, and if there was a way to make this project work with some sort of one-way approach to the loop that connects Hamlin Street and is it South Street, and what's the cross street? Is it
Dermot?
That would be of interest. I don't know if that's possible. I think to echo Paul's comments in a less eloquent way, coming from a non-traffic engineer, to the extent this development goes forward, I just want to see it as difficult as possible to cut through. And if that means sidewalks in existing neighborhoods, I disagree with the assertion that it's not fair. I would be inclined to require that as a condition of approval. I just want to see this pass through, if it does happen, to be as difficult as possible. That's just sort of a global approach. Lastly, on John's comment, the access through existing neighborhoods, is this Mr. Bryan alluded to this issue in his letter with respect to the Mitchell Heights, the existing, is it Mitchell Heights neighborhood?
Mitchell Highlands.
Mitchell Highlands, thank you. And I'm wondering if we have done the necessary due diligence with town council, town attorney, to see if there are any issues here.
We've done that a couple of times with other projects, but I did note that, and my expectation was that the applicant would be doing the appropriate legal research in time for the next meeting.
Okay. go ahead.
Not to make this any more difficult, but under our dead-end road standard, you need to have two means of access into the project. However, an emergency access road that is built to our standards for emergency access roads is considered a second means of access. So this applicant could be instructed to divide the project in half and connect it with an emergency access road in the middle.
Could you explain that a little bit more, Maureen? I'm not sure I understand.
Well, the logical division would probably be Tom, if you could point to the area just above Chicory.
Could you also take this down again, please?
Oh, sorry.
And I'm not advocating this, but I know the applicant would like some direction as soon as possible. And I mean, this is, I think we want on South Street. On South Street, just the new part of South Street, just up above Chicory Way.
Keep going.
Where the trail is.
Oh, okay.
Right, Somewhere in, just above, you will know. No, you need to keep Chicory Way. Just above Chicory Way. Move your, right?
On South Street.
Right there.
I thought I was there, sorry.
Somewhere in there. I mean, the board could, I mean, the applicant could do this and still build the project.
It's getting close to 10 o'clock, and I'm trying to figure out how best we ought to proceed. There are just a couple of things that I would invite the abutters to do if they're interested. We've heard a lot about potential traffic calming devices. We didn't hear much in the way of testimony about whether people think sidewalks in their existing neighborhoods, assuming this happened, assuming this development went forward, whether they think that's a good idea. I think some of you did outline that in your emails, but that's public comment that we would appreciate getting via email or letter. I don't know, Maureen, have neighborhood groups ever gotten together and hired their own traffic experts?
Yes.
So to the extent you're concerned that you're not getting an impartial view by the applicant's traffic engineers or by the peer review that we obtain through the town, there's nothing that would prevent the abutters from hiring their own traffic engineer. Obviously, that costs money. But that's something that I just threw out there as that you might want to consider. But we obviously have a lot of work to do. The hour is getting late. I don't know if there's any, you probably need a lot more guidance from us than we've given you so far, but I'm not sure we're able to do much more given the time. Does the board have any thoughts as to what we ought to do here? John?
Can I allow the board to just, I'd like to ask Dale Brewer, while he's here this evening, to respond to some of the comments that were made by the neighbors regarding the wetlands and the vernal pool while Dale is here.
That's fine.
Okay.
And one of the issues that I'd be curious about is, well, we'll let him speak first. Okay.
John wanted me to speak about the vernal pool issues, and there's been some emails circulating around town with some concerns about vernal pools. At this stage, there was a meeting last week. The regulatory committee was meeting with the federal and the state agencies. They're still trying to draft a proposal for the legislation to put legislation or regulation on vernal pools. Currently, there is none. They're proposing a 250-foot setback from significant vernal pools. Every pool in the woods, every depression that you see that's filled with water is not a vernal pool. There has to be indicator species that I am very aware of. My first vernal pool seminar that I attended was in Massachusetts in 1995. It was well prior to vernal pools were even known about in Maine practically. There are some individuals that have been pushing for this legislation for a long time, and it all stemmed basically from southern New England states. With that being said, I have identified vernal pools on other localities, towns, Falmouth, for example, this summer. I know the indicator species and what to look for. Knowing the controversial situation this was going to probably lead to, this subdivision, I actually went to the site several occasions looking for these indicator species in these particular, the upper pool in A, this pool is about the only chance, in my professional opinion, of being a vernal pool. So I spent a lot of time on different dates. Actually, my first date there, it was still frozen. I met with Albert Frick. He was reviewing some of the wetlands down in this area, apparently for the town, when this land was sold to the developers. We concurred that at that time there was RP1 wetlands down here, and we basically agreed where the buffer from the RP1 wetlands would come. And we also discussed, you know, some wetland issues along these lots that were for sale. But a few weeks lapsed. I personally went to the site looking again for egg masses, juvenile larvae from these amphibians or the invertebrates, the fairy shrimp. I did not see any egg masses in any of my visits there. I was on the site 10 times, not all specifically looking for the vernal pools, but at least 4 times looking in this pool for, and I looked at all the pools, actually, all the wetlands for any of these indicator species, and I never once saw any of these species in any of their immature stages, and I should have had, I was there at the right proper time for the breeding season. These egg masses, it takes 55 to 127 days for these eggs to mature, depending on, you know, millions of factors, water temperature, whatnot. I should have seen something had they been there. And with that all being said, the jurisdiction that's proposed will be on significant vernal pools. Significant vernal pools, as it's laid out right now and proposed, would have 10 or more egg masses from blue-spotted salamanders, or it would be the presence of fairy shrimp, or 20 or more egg masses from spotted salamanders, or 40 or more egg masses from wood frogs. I personally have been involved with taking some of these egg masses, not from these pools at this site, but from known vernal pools, brought them back to our environmental, where I used to work. We had an environmental department. We hatched these eggs out. We fed these amphibians in for months, and then we released them into vernal pools that we mitigated. We created vernal pools, and we released these. I know what these eggs look like. I know what the stages of growth of these amphibians are, and there weren't any at this site. And actually, this upper portion, typically significant vernal pools, in my professional opinion, occur more readily in deciduous forest. This is a mature stand of hemlocks. It's very dark. It's very cold. And there's very little litter for the egg masses to attach themselves to in this pool. On July 20th, when I revisited this site and I took my last photographs, the pool was completely dried up. I had been there the week prior to this drying up, and there weren't any of these indicator species, or I would have documented them, and I would have put them in my report. I don't know what else to say from that. I covered my bases. I personally do not believe, in my professional opinion, that these are significant vernal pools at this site.
What time of year can one study the vernal pools and find these?
Typically after the pools have de-iced. There is activity, I guess, prior. It'd be limited activity prior to ice out, but from ice out until July 20th is when this pool completely dried out. So we're talking the middle of April, May, June, the early portions of July, which I was at this site working. And
if we were to hire our own wetlands expert, that expert wouldn't be able to study this issue then until mid-April?
No, they may be able to provide a habitat characterization, but in order to actually determine a significant vernal pool, you would have to identify these species, in which you wouldn't be able to do until the ice is out.
Does anybody have any other questions? Is there any other issue you wanted to raise before we concluded tonight? David?
Just one issue. We heard a lot tonight about the continuation of South Street. And I've heard some comments about it prior to this meeting. But, Maureen, is there some issues that you might put on the table for us to think about the next time regarding this and why we ended up in this direction.
Yeah, a portion of South Street that the applicant could be required to build was actually the subject of a private accessway permit approved by this planning board just a year or two ago. So, you know, we've had a hand in the current condition of South Street. The only other thing I would suggest the board consider is that that neighborhood, the South Street, the Stevenson and most of South Street has actually been there for quite a while, and the Hamlin Street section is a lot newer. It's in and of itself, it's a relatively small neighborhood, and you would be asking, if you go with a one-way loop concept, I mean, just from a neighborhood functioning perspective, you'd be asking people who have been driving down Stevenson Street for 30 years, they can't do that anymore. They're going to have to go all the way around just to go home. And I would just question, and maybe we want the traffic engineer to comment on it, but it just doesn't seem like a big enough neighborhood to put them into a one-way loop situation. But it's just something to think. I mean, I'm not talking about the cut-through traffic. I'm just saying about the way a neighborhood functions. One-way traffic is usually something you look at a much higher volume type of road.
Thank you. Just one comment on South Street, or a couple comments. South Street, well, first of all, both traffic studies, our traffic study and the peer review traffic study, didn't mention or recommend that we needed South Street to accommodate our traffic. We have the right to use Dermont and Hamlin. Dermont and Hamlin have plenty of capacity for the minimal amount of traffic that we're going to generate to improve, extend, and improve South Street, which I understand to be over 800 feet long, is going to be just unbelievably expensive. We may have to go in and box cut, put new gravel in, sidewalks, curbing, paving, esplanade, trees. 800 feet times a rule of thumb of 250 to 300 dollars per foot is just, I think, too expensive to ask this applicant to do when, in fact, we don't need South Street. So, Craig, if you have any other comments, or Skip. No?
Do we, I think at this point we probably need a motion to table this application to the next hearing. David?
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Spurwink Woods LLC for preliminary subdivision review and resource protection permit for Spurwink Woods, a 42-unit subdivision located between Dermot Drive and Kildare Road, be tabled to the regular January 17, 2006 meeting of the Planning Board.
Second. Further discussion? All those in favor? Okay, motion carries. We actually have another agenda item for the Planning Board, and we typically, as I understand the rules, do not take up new items after 10 o'clock. However, I would, if at all possible, like to get this one done. So I would need a motion to suspend the rules so that we can begin discussion of this agenda item.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? We actually have more business to get to, so please send us your comments Thanks for coming out.
What's up?
Again, under new business, only an hour and 50 minutes behind schedule. Bob and Susan Raftus are requesting a private access by permit and resource protection permit to construct a driveway for a lot with insufficient frontage located off Spurwink Avenue on proposed Fairway Drive. A single proposed lot has been assembled from three legal non-conforming lots from a prior subdivision and additional land purchased from an abutter. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 19-7-9, Private Accessways, and Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit. At this point, I would invite the applicant to come to the podium and introduce the project.
Thank you. It's Bob Raftus, the applicant. The property is a 1.1-acre parcel of land on the east side of Spurwink Avenue. There's an existing 40-foot wide paper street that runs through the property. It turns at this point and runs out to Caputic Drive. The abutters to the north, there are single-family residences to the north, vacant land owned by Caputic Club to the east, a single-family residence to the south, and Spurwink Avenue to the west. The dark tree line represents the tree lines. Most of this front area is an open meadow, wetland. What is shaded in green is the limit of the wetland. There's a stream that crosses the property in this location here. It originates from the pond on the 18th hole at Caputic. It runs across this property, intersects with another stream that runs under Spurwink Avenue and eventually runs from Brook. The property is serviced by public sewer and public water and overhead electric telephone and cable in Spurwink Avenue. The proposal is a request to provide a private access way because the lot lacks the required frontage. We are required to bring a private access way in, which we have run down the middle of the 40-foot wide paper street with the required emergency turnaround located here. The private access way runs in 177 feet. From that point, the driveway would extend off the end of the private access way and provide service to the building lot, which is located here. The light brown represents the building envelope and is defined by the side and rear setbacks, as well as a 75-foot stream setback running parallel with the stream. The project will extend from there's an 8-inch sewer and an 8-inch water in Spurwink. Will provide the service to the lot as well as underground electric telephone and cable will extend to the lot. In your packet is a stormwater management plan that was prepared by Lethbridge at BH2M that analyzed the pre and post development drainage. Basically, we're going to direct the runoff that comes off this private access way to the existing stream. And it will enter the stream on either side of the driveway.
We're also providing a 30-inch culvert underneath the driveway to accommodate the 25-year storm event. We're proposing to fill proposing to fill 5,100 square feet of wetland to construct this private access way in the turnaround. We have filed both a NRPA application and a permit by rule stream crossing permit with DEP. We have also met with the Conservation Commission last week, presented this plan, and they voted to approve the resource protection permit, voted to recommend approval of the resource protection permit with a condition that the applicant allow 2,500 square feet of wetland to grow back in its natural form. So I've designated the 2,500 square foot area that the applicant has agreed to meet that condition. This wetland has been maintained over the years by the existing owner, Mr. Rumry. He's periodically mowed the wetland, and Bob would like to continue doing that. We are asking for one waiver on the resource protection permit, and that is a waiver on the high-intensity soil survey. We have submitted in your packet a medium-intensity survey, a wetland delineation that was performed by Mark Hampton, and this will be served by public sewer and public water. Referring to Maureen's memo, I think the only memo under the private access way permit was referred to the calculations. They were submitted. I think they were just misplaced. But those have been submitted to Steve Harding, and I received an email today from Steve basically concurring with our calculations. And then there was Steve Harding's comments letter with a few comments dated December 12th. We have, they're very minor in nature. We agree with all of them. And in fact, we have prepared a response, which we're going to submit to Steve tomorrow. Number eight in his letter asking us to contact the Portland Water District, Steve Sloan from the Portland Water District, because it's the district that actually owns and maintains the sewer in Springwick Road. We have contacted Mr. Sloan. We have received an email from him indicating his approval of how we're showing the proposed sewer connection. So with that, there's no neighbors.
You don't have a traffic study?
No traffic study.
Any stop signs?
Well,
I guess request of the board, if we've met all of your concerns, that if it's possible to grant final approval, we would appreciate it.
Okay. Well,
thank you.
Thank you. The first issue that we need to get through this evening is completeness. It doesn't appear that we have any issues there. Are there any questions or discussion on that front? Do we have a motion? David?
Motion for the board to consider it ordered that based on plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Bob and Susan Raftus for a private accessway permit and a resource protection permit to construct a driveway for a lot with insufficient frontage located off Sprowink Ave on proposed Fairway Drive be deemed complete.
We have a motion. It's been seconded by Barbara. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries. What are the board's thoughts on whether we could move this forward to final approval tonight, or whether a public hearing or a site walk is necessary?
Have you heard from anybody?
I did have one gentleman come in to see me today who lives on the other side of Spurwink Ave. He has concerns about stormwater. I explained, we went over the plans, and I explained his opportunity to have a public hearing, and he said he did not feel he needed to speak on this. So that's the only inquiry I've had.
If we were to move in that direction, there are some minor outstanding issues, and I'm not discouraging approval. I'm just saying we'd have to cover those somehow. John said that he's got a response to...
Are you referring to the town engineer's letter?
Right.
Right, and what we've done in the past is make the approval subject to fulfillment of those conditions.
We could just make that as a condition.
Right. Board feel that would be the way to go? And it seems like that would make sense. I don't know, it's just because we're worn out after tonight's hearing.
I don't see any reason why I wouldn't head in that direction anyway.
Right, no, I agree.
No. But we haven't seen the response yet, right?
I can review them with you.
Yep.
It'd take 2 minutes.
Sure.
Good to put on record.
Yep. Could you leave do you have an extra copy to leave with us tonight?
I'll leave with us. Okay. Yeah. Steve's number one, no comment necessary. Number two, completeness understanding, no comment necessary. Number three, stormwater management report. This was misplaced, is that correct, Marie?
Just to make it clear, what usually happens, this one needs to be made clear. What we do offer applicants, because the board usually doesn't like to review the calculations, so we usually tell the applicant, if you submit two copies, one for the town files, one for the town engineer, that will be sufficient. Well, they were submitted in a stack that looked exactly like this. So what happened is all the regular applications, and no one noticed that you actually had two stormwater reports underneath, and they weren't marked to my attention or the engineer's attention. So we found them the day we were distributing the packages. So yes, they were submitted, but they were not reviewed.
But they have been reviewed.
They have since been reviewed.
And we received an email.
Yes. You provided an extra copy to the town engineer, and he provided an email today stating that he had reviewed the calculations and he found them acceptable. And I think a copy of that email is on your desk this evening.
That's right.
Also included in number three, Steve recommended that we design the culvert inlet and outlet right here as an emergency spillway, so that during a real high, believe me, this will never happen, but because this is such
never a say never,
this is such a small stream, but in the event that this, if the water overflows the culvert and overflows the road, this is the low point of the drive here, that we provide sufficient riprap in that area to act as a spillway. So we have done that. This, believe me, this stream is this. Number four, he agrees with the 30-inch culvert. No comment necessary. Number five, he just indicated that we should provide the town with a copy of the permit, or submit the permit by rule in NERPA applications to DEP and copies to the town. We had already done this. I guess he had not received copies of it, but that has been filed with DEP. We're waiting for approval on those, and they have been filed with the town.
John,
yes.
Just for the record, I do have a copy of your permit, your DEP permits. You provided them to
yes,
me, and they are on did. File.
Right. Thank you. Number six, high-intensity soils mapping. He agrees with the waiver request. Water and sewer service trenches. He would like us to, on our initial plans, we had the sewer and the water extending. They were 10 feet apart.
But the sewer is on the far side, or the water, I'm sorry, the water is on the far side, the sewer is on the near side. He wanted us to, and we agreed, to cut one trench rather than jog the trench in Spurwink Avenue so that when the patch is done, that it's in a more uniform patch rather than with a jog in it. So we've revised the utilities plan to reflect that. And the sewer connection in Portland Water District, I explained that we have received an email from Steve Sloan approving our sewer connection. Number nine is he wanted us to label the exact type of geotextile fabric underneath the roadway, which we did. It's a Marafi 500X, and that's on the detail. And
any further questions or discussion? Does anybody have a motion they're willing to, Peter?
I have a motion for the board to consider. I move that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Bob and Susan Raft is for a private accessway permit and a resource protection permit to construct a driveway for a lot with insufficient frontage located off Spurwink Avenue on the proposed Fairway Drive be approved, subject to the applicant making the changes as stated by Mr. Mitchell in his presentation in response to the town engineer's letter dated December 12, 2005.
Second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We do have one final item, but I think can that wait till the next?
I would really urge,
if you hear about
this item, we should get it off our table as soon as possible, because I don't know how long it's going to be reviewed by other bodies.
Then could you?
Yes.
Okay, the last item under other business is the bisected lots amendment. The Planning Board is considering a recommendation to the Town Council that Section 19-7-13 bisected lots be amended to clarify that the provision applies to single-family home lots. The amendment will be considered under the zoning amendment procedures located in Section 19-10-3 amendments. Maureen, I would ask you to briefly describe the proposed amendment.
There is a provision in the ordinance that says that if you have a lot that's bisected by a public or private road, you must have the minimum lot size required on at least one side of the road. This has been a situation we've experienced usually with old lots where rights of way have been conveyed over one property to another lot, and you end up in an unusual and an undesirable situation where you have an old road right of way that's actually going through the middle of a lot. Although we've also had a couple of occasions where brand new lots have been created and the developers have created lots and created new road rights of way where the lot was on both sides of the road. And there was a real concern that there was some desire to underhandedly create unbuildable lots and then sell them. So this bisected lots amendment has always been used to deal with these types of single family lot issues. However, we've now discovered that with the code officer, with the advice of the town attorney, has stated that the bisected lots amendment must apply to any lot where there's a minimum lot size. And what this is doing is where you have campus-like developments, such as condominium projects or institutional projects, where you might have a public road run through the middle of a project, you are penalizing being able to have that public road because you're now saying that, say, a 5-acre or a 10-acre minimum lot size has to be located all on one side of the road. So it's actually hampering what might be a public purpose in, on occasion, creating public rights of way through campus-style developments. So this amendment would make it clear that the bisected lot provision would only apply to single-family dwelling lots.
Which is what was intended when it was passed.
I believe that is exactly what it was intended for.
When we had this discussion in the workshop, I do want to compliment Barbara because she did come up with the exact wording that I think actually
accurately reflects what we were trying to do when it was passed in the first place. So unless there's any other discussion, I have a motion for the board to consider.
Oh.
You do?
I'm sorry. Well, this seems a little futile, but I need to open this up for a public hearing. Anybody wishing to speak may come forward to the podium and offer their comments. Seeing none, I will now close the public hearing. We did discuss this at a workshop last month and actually had a rather lengthy discussion, which resulted in Barbara's suggested language. Is there any further questions or comments from the board at this time? Okay, Peter.
I have a motion for the board to consider. I move that based on the materials and facts presented, the planning board recommends the bisected lots amendment to the zoning ordinance of the town council for adoption.
Second. Motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor? Okay, the motion carries.
Motion to adjourn.
Okay, and before we get to the motion to adjourn, I just want to thank John Ciraldo for coming to what will be his last hearing of the planning board, and he picked quite an evening to pick his last hearing. But John has been on the planning board for 6 years? Oh, okay.
Just feels that way.
In excess of 6 years, and has been an invaluable member of the planning board, served as chair before I took over that role, and he's been a tough act to follow. And he is rotating off the board at the end of this year, and I just want to thank him for all of his years of service to the board and to the town.
And we're going to miss you.
Thank you.
John, as your final act of a member of the planning board, would you like to make a motion?
Move to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Motion carries. Thank you.
Listen, before everybody goes,